do have the draft ready, so we'll go ahead and bring that up right now and get our best of five finals action underway.
The draft
now, as we kick things off here, it looks like SK Prometheus do have the first ban advantage, and we talked about SK's ability to basically play whatever they want. And it's kind of a similar deal with G2, where they can play a lot of different things, but they're more like cerebral in the banning phase. Really, if they think things through, they're two steps ahead when it comes to banning. So talk about this, Rome, and how do you think things are going to play out here?
Honestly, both of these teams are very well known in terms of running a scarf and running a cruel composition. And I think this is exactly what is going to start getting picked up really quickly. Reverting to their comfort rules and making sure like they're marching out of the gate like with their foot in their shoes, instead of going too far and being too innovative that it might cause them to lose track, especially during this best out of five series.
Yeah, definitely. You have that struggle, right, between comfort picks, counter picking, and then of course picking to the meta and trying to just get in where you fit in. But these guys, they're going to get some comfort picks in that Cruel, but it's answered with the Sky Arden. We haven't seen a lot of Sky, but she has looked very strong.
Yeah, and I think SK Prometheus here is going to follow up with a Catherine and a Scarf. And this is the kind of composition that works out really well for them. They've executed excellent yesterday against the Team Secret team. But how can G2 Kingwin actually approach against this? They do have a very dominant early game in terms of grabbing that Sky and that Arden, putting them together into that jungle. But they also need somebody like... You have Sky that is able to dive very far, but you have to split up the focus for the SK team. If you're gonna get somebody in that lane, preferably, I think a Ringo here would do them really well.
All right, well, it's Scarf picked up, and these guys are gonna have an incredible composition. I think SK very happy with the way things worked out here. Catherine gonna round it out nicely, and G2 just kind of sitting here looking for that last pick. It's gonna be a Glaive. So maybe a little bit different than what we talked about, but do you think this is going to be used to success here?
They have a great chance of actually diving onto the enemy team, but I feel like when you're going up against a Cruel, it's very hard to like play from behind, especially if you have a Glaive on your team. You do have that afterburn, you do have a great chance to peel, but in terms of duking it out, negating damage from your allies, it is very hard, and I expect like the SK Prometheus team just to constantly dive down this Sky.
All right, well, we'll keep our eyes on it. Will they dive that Sky down? Who will be the victor of game one? We've loaded into the Halcyon Fold, and with that, we'll toss it over to Action Jackson and Vedius. Take it away.
All right, thanks a bunch, guys. We are here for our final series of the second qualifiers. Who's going to take it away, SK Prometheus or G2 Kingwin? Vedius, this is going to be an awesome one. Let's get straight into it.
Yep, it should be pretty good, and I was excited as to how quickly G2 locked in their picks. To me, it seemed like they came in here with a plan, and this game one should be a stellar one. Waldemar going on to his Fabled. They go for a collapse on the Potato.
Yeah, but he's easily able to afterburn out of there. That's one of the advantages of something like Glaive in lane. You do have a great ability to get away from things with that afterburn, so it's going to be safe for now. We'll have to see if they make another rotation up there anytime soon. That's allowed for G2 to take a few of these camps away, though.
Yeah, they've taken a few of the forward camps. Now they're rotating round into the back half of SK's jungle. They want to try and look for a fight.
Yeah, they might be able to find one. They do steal away one of those creeps. So big gold going over to Red X. They're doing some nice damage on the jetpacks as well. Look at the Surrey strike for Barrage 2. Forces him away. G2 saying, you shouldn't be taking that Cruel away from Dark Potato. It's our Cruel.
It's our Cruel! Why would you do that to us? But still, I don't think he's going to be too happy. Really excited to see Dark Potato on this Glaive. I think that he's going to be attempting to peel apart the enemy with his massive axe, which I imagine would be a pretty good peeling tool. Maybe not in a practical sense, but in a destroying enemy sense.
Perhaps. I mean, I'm just a little bit upset that he's not playing Cruel, because I prepared a joke specifically for that.
Well, you'll just have to wait and see. We've got plenty of games for you to use that opportunity. But G2, continuing their aggression, may have caught Raph out of position, and they're going to be doing a bit of invading. Jetpacks can see this. He's going to do a bit of counter jungling himself. So this is very smart from SK. They realize, okay, we can't fight in our own jungle. Let's just give it away. Let's just take the enemies because they're not in a position to stop us. So smart stuff from them. And so far, very standard, very passive early game.
That might change in a moment, though. Waldemar's got to be careful here. He's going to spot G2 out, I believe, after moving into that bush. Now Dark Potato gets ganked by Raph, but he should be able to get away. He's actually going aggressive here, knocking him into the turret. Very bold decision by Dark Potato. He's going to be safe for now, though.
Yeah, absolutely fine. He's going to be taking a bit of harass, but in terms of his farm, he's doing very, very well, keeping in line with Waldemar. We'll have to keep an eye on those farm scores as the game progresses, because I'm curious to see whether or not anyone can match Kavathas, to be honest. As ooh, jetpacks.
Oh, Raph's in a really bad spot. They're actually committing onto jetpacks. They want this kill rather than the other one. It is onto the Kroll, a more valuable target. And they do find it. First blood going the way of G2.
Though G2 consistently applying that aggression, and finally it pays off in their favor, using that Crystal Power Sky, picking up a bunch of early crystal bits so that your forward barrage does do a fair chunk of damage. Noted, we are on patch 1.14, so that forward barrage has had a few nerfs to it. It does do a little bit less crystal damage, but still, it still packs a punch if you're going to take a face full of it.
Yeah, that is very true. Right now, SK trying to rotate back towards this lane, maybe find Dingo here, but he is going to be able to get away relatively healthy. You know, it only takes about half of his damage there, and Arden can regenerate that quite easily. Got Sky, Reddick's just farming up the jungle for now. Playing it slow, trying to get strong as fast as possible. Got to be careful here, doesn't have a lot of energy. Using the forward barrage onto Raph, onto jetpacks. Got that Surrey strike as well, and now with Dingo here, they might turn this one around. Jetpacks is in a tough spot, he falls. Now they're going onto Raph as well. The aggression is non-stop from the G2 lineup. We saw in the lane though, Waldemar 1v1 in Dark Potato, finds that kill. And Raph, oh, he checks the bush, and Dingo finds the kill. That was overall a 2-for-1 in favor of G2.
And G2 are going to be able to pick up some back camps off the back of that. Again, G2 just consistently applying pressure and doing what they can to catch SK out of position and utilizing the fact that SK have the weaker early game composition, and G2 are just abusing that right now. But Dark Potato, somewhat of a misplay up in the lane, thinking that he can go head-to-head with Waldemar, but this guy is renowned for his scarf play, and while yesterday he had a bit of a rough laning phase, he's trying to change that as he gets stunned under turret.
Oh, Waldemar in a tough spot there. Actually does take some turret damage, but he is going to be able to run back to the safety of Raph, of jetpacks. Get out of there. So Dark Potato's aggression not going as well as he might like so far. Flare going to spot out G2. Got to be careful about going in 2v3 here.
They could come out ahead at this point in game simply due to the level advantage Reddix has. He does have the death from above, but he is going to hold on to it. Decided not to pop that just yet. So G2, they're just going to pick up a couple items and return to the farm game.
Yeah, not doing anything too crazy just yet. Reddix does need to be careful here, though. Jetpacks and Raph are nearby. He's going to Surrey strike back a little bit, put some forward barrage damage down. They're actually baiting him in, though. Waldemar comes through with the dragon. Massive damage down onto Reddix, and now Dingo in a very bad spot. Tries to turn it around onto Waldemar, buy some more time, but he goes down. They've evened up the kill score at 3-for-3.
Very smart play from Jetpacks, hiding in the brush and waiting for Reddix to burn all of his cooldowns onto trying to catch what G2 believe was the out of position Raph. But
whoa,
he may be out of position now.
Dark Potato going in. The minion looking for Raph but can't find it. And now Dark Potato in a very bad spot. Stacks coming through from Jetpacks onto Dark Potato, picks up the kill. Reddix, I don't know if he's going to be able to find this one either. We can Stacks doing a lot of work. We've got backup from Dingo this time. There's death from above. Jetpacks finally goes down. But ultimately, that was two kills picked up for the side of SK Prometheus.
So what you saw was SK trying to utilize the advantage that they've just gained and push it. They end up getting punished due to the collapse from Dark Potato, and while he did lose his life, he bought enough time for both Reddix and Dingo to rotate round from their base with the items that they just picked up and pick themselves up two easy kills. So overall, in the whole duration of that fight, it ends up being a 3-for-2 in favor of G2. So good stuff from them, and this game still very tense between 3-for-2 in favor of SK. It was in favor of SK, so very back and forth game. This is very much what we expected coming into this final.
It is indeed. G2 do sit at a fairly substantial gold lead of 1,000, which considering they're only one kill up is a fairly big deal, But SK certainly have capabilities of pulling that lead back a little bit. Dingo, gotta be careful here. He's got backup from the rest of G2. Might see our first 3-on-3 team fight in just a moment. With the poke coming out of Waldemar, though, they've got to be really careful. Look at the Spitfires going down onto Dingo. Hurting in a big way right now. Reddix on the front line, charging in with the forward barrage, gets some nice damage down. Looks like SK are just going to back away.
G2 now completed some big items. Wouldn't be surprised if Dark Potato, there it is. There's the Sorrow Blade. Now that he's gone, I wouldn't be surprised if G2 look for a fight.
Oh, Dingo immediately gets picked up, though. Jetpack's in a tough spot. There's going to be him knocked into Reddix from Hell's Heart. Flies wide, but lands on the Dark Tato on the rebound. Big stun coming through from the side of SK. Even with Jetpacks dead, can Reddix find any kills here in the 1 versus 2? He's got a lot of damage. Reflex block not going to be enough. The front cam picks up the kill. Reddix, he wants more. Doesn't have Surrey Strike available, so he's not going to find it. It's a 2-for-2. Very close fights between these teams.
Holy moly, Reddix stepping up this game, demonstrating his proficiency on that sky to reposition, land those skill shots, and reliably get down the damage that he has with this completed Frostburn. He does such a good job of repositioning and just kiting around these fights, allowing Dingo and Dark Potato to just soak up the majority of the damage. But you do have to give props for Dark Potato there. His use of the Afterburn to set Jetpacks into a position that they could then collapse and shut him down was really what enabled G2 to turn that fight around. But as you said, very back and forth between these two teams, and they may be looking for another fight as they pick up a couple items in the shop.
They do indeed. Look at that damage from the forward barrage. There's the gauntlet. Dingo finds the stun onto Raph 29. They want to go for the kill, and they find it. Big pickup for G2. Got to be careful underneath this turret, though. Waldemar, still full health, still full energy, basically. Can go for a lot of poke damage. Dingo might have bitten off more than he can chew here. Jetpacks finds that return kill. Over-aggression gets checked by SK.
Yeah, that could have been a miscommunication, or it could have just been over-aggression, but Reddix wasn't there. At the moment, he is their main damage dealer for G2, and without his presence, there's very little that G2 can come ahead against Jetpacks and Waldemar. And off the back of the numbers advantage, SK are going to get a turret.
Dark Potato got to be careful here. Jet's doing some good damage. Reddix just kiting around the side of that fight, using the Surrey Strike to reposition Waldemar. Very low health. A reflex block at the last second keeps him alive. Reddix might want to look for more here, but he doesn't have the Surrey Strike. Can't go for the kill. Waldemar just barely able to get out of there.
Very close stuff from Waldemar. I feel he should have lost his life there. If I was Reddix, I would be like, no, please. But unfortunately, Reddix not going to be able to pick that one up. G2 end up losing a turret. They're losing a bit of momentum, but they still hold on to the gold lead, which is really the most impressive thing for me so far. And it all comes off the back of Dark Potato maintaining a CS advantage over Waldemar.
Reddix too,
holding an even bigger CS advantage over his opponent in Jetpacks.
Yeah, I mean, we're seeing a lot of CS focus coming through in the final day of this qualifier. Obviously, we saw it last series with Kvalifar. Goldmine is full right now, so both of these teams trying to hover around, maybe go for that one. Bingo might want to go for an engage as well, but Reddix, he's disappeared. He's actually going for back camps on SK's side of the map right now, leveraging that positioning. Dingo in a tough spot, miles away from home, tries to gauntlet over the wall, but he can't get out. SK with an easy pickup. It's Dark Potato and Reddix against the world right now if they want to stop this gold mine, and I'm sure they do because it is chock-a-block full of money right now.
Certainly is. Dingo a little bit out of position. Not sure if he wanted to provide support for Reddix or if you wanted to just get some vision down. Either way, he's gonna have to give that one away from Hell's Heart comes out.
Yeah, it does stun up Dark Potato. That's gonna be the Dragon's Breath as well, but here comes Death from Above. Reddix repositions over the wall, but he does take a lot of damage from Jetpacks. Sorry, from Waldemar over the wall. Dark Potato might try and go in here. He's got Afterburn, finds Waldemar with that, goes back, giving him a little bit of assistance right now. Big speed up comes through and a nice crit out of Dark Potato. Grabs that kill. Very nice work by them, but doesn't make up for the hefty payout that the gold mine just dished out.
It certainly does not. You can see the goal gap now all of a sudden very quickly closing. But Dark Potato, he wants to try and rectify that by once again stealing SK's back camps. And this has been consistent from the G2 lineup. Typically, we've been seeing it come out from Reddix, but Dark Potato, knowing how strong he is, feels confident enough to do it himself. And while he did have a bit of a rough laning phase, he is comfortably working his way back into the game. Sora Blade picked up. Not actually picking up any major items just yet. You can see sitting on just under 800 gold, wants to wait for a little bit more before he decides to pick up his next major item.
Yeah, you can see Reddix right now just used Death from Above to push the wave a little bit. So they're trying to keep pressure up here as much as possible. They know that if lane pressure goes the other way, Waldemar and Jetpacks can wipe through a turret in no time at all. Dark Potato might look for a kill here as well, but they've got to be careful about overextending. Lots of scout traps going down on the side of SK, maintaining a very good vision on their side of the map.
Yeah, they realize how aggressive G2 is trying to be, and they're setting up this vision to enable themselves to predict what G2's battle plan is and what they are trying to do. So at this point, SK, all they can really do is watch as their jungle gets taken away, but now they're feeling a little bit more aggressive. Waldemar, he's completed both the Broken Myth and the Frostburn, so he's at a great point to really start kiting around, getting this utility down, as well as start hitting hard thanks to that Broken Myth pickup. So Waldemar feeling very comfortable as we approach the mid-game.
He is, but Dark Potato wants to put him out of his comfort zone. Lots of damage coming through from the G2 lineup. Find themselves that kill. Gauntlet didn't end up stunning him up. We did see the reflex block come through, but the kill went across, and that's what matters. G2, they're going to try and leverage that and pick up a turret.
They realize that they have the numbers advantage. They also realize that SK had just taken the gold miner, so they feel that they're in the positional advantage. But I don't know how quickly they're going to be able to take this turret down. Dingo feels pretty quickly.
Maybe not that, though. He's going to have to back away. Dark Potato in 1 versus 2 right now. Putting forward some good damage, but from Hell's Heart comes across. He's got max stacks on top of him. Dark Potato in a very tough spot. Jetpacks finds himself that kill. Reddix just wasn't there backing up the team. He had to recall after picking up a Broken Myth. Going for a little bit of back camp, stealing away there.
This is something that we're seeing a lot from G2 right now. Dark Potato and Dingo gaining an advantage and then throwing it away by trying to be too aggressive. And now, once again, SK look to try and take another turret with the numbers advantage.
Reddix has so much damage right now that you see Waldemar forced to burn that Dragon's Breath to try and get them off of their backs. But Reddix wants more. That's going to be the goop going down. Can't set it on fire, though. Reddix is taking a lot of pain. Dingo just body blocking the Spitfires right now. Reddix actually pops a reflex block to stay healthy there. So, Waldemar, this is exactly what you want to be doing as a Scarf, just applying that consistent damage, making it difficult for your opponents to capitalize on any positioning of your team.
Exactly that. When you have the Frostburn, if you land one skill shot, it makes it so much easier to land the rest. And with the damage that you have available to you from the Broken Myth, you can just consistently apply this Broken. You're seeing it right now.
Dark Potato got gnocchied out. That was absolutely massive pickup for SK right as the Kraken spawns. Not sure that there's anything that G2 can really do here. They might try. Reddix and Dingo are on the peripheral here, moving in a little bit. There's the Gauntlet going down. Doesn't find any stuns, though. Maybe they can steal this one away. I'm sure that's what they're going to want to do. But look at the zoning. There's from Hell's Heart. Jetpacks finds a stun. Waldemar, very low health right now. There's a silence coming out from RAF 29. First member to go down is Dingo, and Reddix is in a bad spot. Jetpacks wants to find this kill. He gets it. The Kraken still easily obtainable for SK. They are miles in the lead off the back of that. Very big fight for them.
So even with the Kraken pounding down onto the entire lineup of SK, they're still able to kite around the kiting expert of this Sky and come out ahead. Really well executed fight from SK. They kite back from the gauntlet, which was supposed to knock them up. They avoid the death from above. They then throw out the silence to prevent the mobility from Reddix, and it's simply just an easy cleanup. They get themselves two clean kills, they get themselves a Kraken, and now with the damage that Waldemar is consistently applying, they can set up for a siege to try and break into the base of G2.
They can indeed, and they've got a lot of their cooldowns available right now. We've only got 2 more seconds on Jetpacks. This is from Hell's Heart. Raph takes a lot of damage right off the bat, though. Dingo, he's just not tanky enough. It doesn't matter. From Hell's Heart lands on a Reddix. The Dragon's Breath canceled by Dark Potato. If he can find some AoE here, maybe they can turn it around. Reddix in a very bad spot, having to run back towards the enemy base. Turret goes down in the meantime. Dark Potato taken out by Raf 29. This is a whitewash, Vettius. SK capitalizing on their lead and going for blood.
And all SK now need to do is prevent Reddix from getting back. He is a large part of the wave clear for G2, and as long as he can't stop the siege, it is very likely that SK are going to be able to close out game one. Kraken still on half health, that's the second turret down. SK going to take the first game in this series pretty comfortably, and what looked like a bit of a shaky start from them, they're able to turn around.
They are indeed. Very impressive plays coming out of SK. G2 weren't able to make anything happen really off the back of the first few kills that Reddix and Dark Potato were able to acquire and the gold lead that they had accrued. Close game though. I mean, there were definitely moments where it could have gone differently if maybe some positioning had been different. Interested to see how this series develops moving forwards, because, you know, if we compare that to the last one, it was definitely doable for G2.
It certainly was. There were many instances where there were a few mechanical misplays, a few positional misplays, and I think both teams played relatively well. It was just SK kept getting these picks down onto G2, and every single time they got a pick, they took a major objective off it. They caught Dingo out, they get themselves a turret. They catch Dark Potato out, they get themselves another turret. They catch Dingo out again, and they get themselves a Kraken. It's simply a matter of G2 just a few too many times getting caught out, giving away these free opportunities for SK to work their way back into the game, and that enabled them to run away with it. So G2, if they can rectify these mistakes, I think they should be able to bring it back in this best of five.
All right, well, we'll have to see what happens moving into the next game, but before we do, Humanist and Rome talk us a little bit more through that game.
Well, Romanist and Human here to break it down for you. No, I'm just kidding. That was pretty funny, though. But SK taking game one, man. Pretty convincing there when they seal the deal. Rome. No, I'm just kidding. But it's a very even matchup between these two teams, both deserving to be here in the finals. SK just coming out a little bit on top there. From my angle, I'm thinking it's got a lot to do with the picks. They got their comfort picks in that Scarf, in that Cruel, and really put it to good use there. You know, from your perspective, Rome, like, how did it play out? What allowed them to make that win happen?
Well, on the side of SK, they did have a lot of trouble coming into that jungle. And it just seems that with the composition that G2 picked out last game, every single mistake they made was punished so heavily, mainly on the fact that the SK team, their composition just scaled so much better than they did. You notice the difference between the CS compared from when you're looking at the Krull and then you're looking at the Sky. Sky had more than double his CS. And the thing here was, Glaive in the end just didn't do too much. And with Scarf, with Krull, your composition scales so much better. Every time they made a good play, they capitalized and they killed somebody on the G2 team. They just pushed it that much further.
Yeah.
And I think, like, as the game grew on, although their goal was fairly even, they just never had the proper engage. And they never had a good chance to take out the SK team.
Yeah, I mean, it's crazy. Like, the gold, it was definitely pretty even. The kills at the end of the game, pretty even overall. Could have gone either way. But I think when you have that late-game comp, if things are fairly even, you're pretty happy with that generally, right? Like, that's your goal when you get that late-game composition, that Cruel, that Scarf, it's not so much to get that early-game advantage, but just kind of, you know, allow yourself to get those resources. You know, but Rome, any last thoughts before we jump into this next draft? You know, anything you wanted to say about that match?
I'm looking at, primarily, I'll probably single out Dark Potato here, just because of all the potato puns we've been hearing these last couple of days. Grabbing a comfort pick is great, but grabbing an ideal comfort pick, I think, could be much more beneficial for the G2 Kingwin side.
All right, well, we'll look at that as we get into the draft. Maybe they get that perfect hero for Dark Potato. Draft ready? We'll bring that up right now. Hop into it and get things underway. It will be G2 Kingwin with the first ban in this draft. SK did have first ban in game one. Do you think this is an advantage to G2?
Going first, they have to make sure they prioritize grabbing something very effective that they can use to counter pick against the SK Prometheus team. And that's all, like, part of the strategy during the drafting phase. When you're going first, you have to make sure that first pick really counts. where your next two pick follows up and makes sure that the strategy and the composition that you really want to push out this game will really work.
Well, I do think this is a great first pick for them as the Cruel. We know SK love it. They just won with it, and they take it away from them. So they're pretty comfortable with this Cruel themselves, and I'm sure they can build a nice composition around it. How do SK approach dealing with this Cruel now?
Most likely, they're going to grab another Scarf. We've been seeing a lot of these European teams primarily put that Scarf up in the lane, where he's so great. As long as you're able to get through that early game, your mid to late game scaling is pretty much off the charts. Just the fact that your positioning is always in the back, and this is something that Europe teams play very well.
Yeah. Also, well, I was gonna say before that came out there, the Adagio pick, but I was thinking, you know, maybe they look to pick up a pedal pretty decent with positioning and able to disrupt those team fights very well. But it's the Adagio pick, so this is gonna be a buff comp coming out of SK Prometheus. What do you think is going to be the last hero that they put into this lineup?
They're also known to run a lot of saw push compositions.
Yeah.
They actually can put into a Vox, but to be honest, I would prefer that they put in a Vox just because they ran a saw composition against Team Secret yesterday, and SK Prometheus pretty much grabbed that Scarf, grabbed that Kroll, and they blew up the other team. So hopefully, like, it doesn't come back and bite them in the butt.
Yeah, definitely don't want to be bit in the butt. Last pick coming out here, it could be that Scarf. I mean, round out this composition very nicely. Take a page out of SK's book and look to win match number two here. They've highlighted the Scarf. Couple seconds left, guys. What are you going to do? Locked it in. Came down to the wire. They're just trying to stress us out here.
So here, I would actually pick a Black Feather up for the SK Prometheus team.
Yeah?
I think grabbing that Black Feather gives them that enables them to actually dive that back line, and he works out so well in terms of evading the Cruel and just going straight for that Scarf. But they can put a saw composition here, they can put a Vox in here that works really well, and it looks like they're gonna go with that.
Well, it looks like, yeah, they're highlighted on the Vox, and I'm sure that they can use it to great effect. Although with this composition, I'm a little scared for SK, but do you have one comp that you prefer over the other as you look at this?
I would have to pick up the G2 Kinguin comp, just to the fact that this is one of their biggest strengths. Having their position, they're always making sure that Cruel is in that front line. He is like the vanguard of that team, with Scarf always standing in the back. And we have seen Reddix many times on this Scarf over and over again. One of the things he does really well is like his engages and how he lands his skill shots.
All right, well, we'll keep our eyes on Reddix and see if he can land those skill shots. We've loaded into the Halcyon Fold, guys, so we'll toss it over to our casters. Action Jackson and Vedius, take it away.
All right, thank you very much, guys. We're here for the second game of this series. Currently, SK Prometheus leading it 1-0. I'm excited to see Dark Potato back on his Kroll pickup. And I was wondering, actually, Vedius, do you think he's a big fan of Moby Dick?
You mean the book, the story?
I do mean the book, yes.
He may very well be. Why do you ask?
Because, From Hell's Heart is the name of Kroll's ultimate, and that's from a quote in Moby Dick.
Ah.
To the last, I grapple with thee. From Hell's Heart, I stab at thee. For hate's sake, spit my last breath at thee.
Hey. Well, Reddix could be his last breath right now.
Jetpack's easily able to pick that one up. Very nice out of the gates for SK. I guess G2 might struggle a little bit off the back of that one. We'll have to see if they can make it work and come back into things strong. Bingo, gonna have to go soak some farm in the lane. Not ideal.
I just want to backtrace. Did you just quote a line from Moby Dick to me?
I did, yeah.
Okay, well, there you go, ladies and gentlemen. Not only are you watching Vainglory, but you're also being educated on English literature, so... Welcome
Have
to Vainglory League.
Waldemar gonna get ganked. Not too much is gonna happen, I think. I don't see Dingo doing that much damage here, right?
Say that.
Waldemar's gonna leave at some point, right? All right,
no, Dingo. Dingo has quite a lot of damage on this Ardent. We've seen weapon power Ardents before. We've seen it do a lot of damage and a lot
we
of
have.
Work.
That's true.
His base stats are surprisingly high, so he can definitely pack a punch. If you let him get in range for that blood for blood.
Yeah, I mean, it does do a decent amount of damage, but you kind of gotta run away with the game. And I think he's still flexible right now. Actually, might be going for a bit of a pick here. Raph 29, gotta be careful against Dark Potato. The stacks are beginning to accrue onto him. Jetpacks finds two people with the slow from his heal, though. That is going to encourage them to back away. Raph, not sure if you wanted to turn around onto this one, though. Reddix has rotated down, finds the goop. That's a big slow. They might find this kill, easily picked up by Dark Potato. I don't feel like Raph should have gone back in there. It's just a little bit overeager.
Exactly that. There was no need to be aggressive once again. You're having to dodge your Catherine. You're not going to have the damage. Dark Potato, I don't think he was quite able to steal that one away. But Jetpack's really struggling right now because Dark Potato and Dingo know they have the numbers advantage and they're easily going to steal away these back camps.
They easily might not do it, actually, because Dingo is going to get wrecked. Easy pickup for Jetpacks on that Adagio. Dingo having a bit of a tough time this game, having to spend some time in lane, having to spend some time dead already, about 3 minutes into it.
Yeah. It's not that bad when you turn dead, though. You can just browse around the map, enjoy the beautiful sights of Vainglory and the wonderful season map that they have at the moment.
Waldemar, looking for Reddix. Gonna have to cut you off there because he is in a bad spot. Way too far up the lane, given that he has no vision, no teammates nearby. G2 have looked like they're falling apart a little bit this game already. It's early to say. I mean, they can definitely come back into it. Don't get me wrong. But some of this positioning has been kind of strange.
They'll have the gold lead, though, but Dark Potato, whoa, he's caught out.
Yeah, that's a lot of damage going through. Waldemar doesn't actually find the bolt part of Sonic Zoom, though, so he can't get the kill. Even still, forcing Dark Potato back, making it hard for him to farm, is going to delay Kroll's power spikes quite a bit.
Certainly will. Waldemar now looking for Reddix, but these guys not giving me an opportunity to explain what exactly it is that they're doing. But quick TLDR, they're fighting a lot, and this is very much what we saw in the first game. Very back and forth skirmishes. Typically it was G2 that was coming out ahead in game one, but SK, they're changing things up into game two as Raph gets collapsed on.
He does indeed. Very extended right now yet again, and a big smite comes through from Dark Potato. He's able to find that one, so two kills now on G2. They're actually in the gold lead as well, even though they're down a kill. Not by a substantial amount, but that's nice to see considering that they've had some strong, or rather some weak positioning so far in the game.
Yeah, early on in the game, oh, Jetpacks, he's now the target focus.
He is indeed, but he's going to be able to get back to his turrets. He's got the support from Raph 29. Dingo is going to be able to get Dark Potato out of here, I would imagine, but he still wants to go for the steal. I think he found it there. I couldn't
quite catch it.
But Jetpacks might go for the kill. Dingo turns it around, but he doesn't have very much fury right now. It's going to be hard for him to jump onto him with Blood for Blood. Raph 29 is still full health as well, and we might see the rotate coming down from Waldemar. He's actually heading towards the shop right now. Doesn't have a lot of energy, but he might have some damage. Now he's got to try and run away. He rotated down to potentially just die. Raph, the next target. G2 and a 2 versus 3 right now are doing an excellent job. They're stealing away another camp. We've got Reddix coming in to reinforce. Now, Waldemar, stop base hit! Oh, he got away! What? What? That was insane.
It was close. I would say that was a bold decision from Waldemar to just base in front of the enemy. And the way he did it with his back turned as well, he's like, I don't even need to look at you. And I'm just going to swag my way out of here. He did just barely make it out of there. So props to Waldemar, understanding that he had enough time before anyone from G2 actually hit him. But still, G2, as you rightly said, momentum very heavily swinging in their favor, not afraid to just go into the enemy jungle, look for these plays, try and catch SK out of position, but still, gold very close between the two teams. Dark Potato now being the one getting stunned up a bit, but I don't think he's going to be too happy about that.
Yeah, he was trying to go in and find a kill, couldn't pick anything up, though. We've got three members of both teams in the lane at the moment. Jetpacks and Raph, a little bit underleveled compared to Dingo and Dark Potato. They got to be careful here. But Waldemar doing a substantial amount of damage already, even though he's on that box. Going the weapon power avenue this time around. So he's going to be hitting pretty hard as we move forward.
Yeah, I think you have a little bit of extra damage compared to the Crystal Power build in the early game when you go for the weapon power, because now all of your basic attacks now do additional damage. Raph now being collapsed on.
Yeah, that's going to land right onto Raph 29. Easy pickup. Dark Potato stabs at thee.
And stabbing works, apparently. So he's able to pick up an easy kill. Is it really a stab when you throw, though?
Well, I mean, I'm referencing Moby Dick again.
Oh, okay, right. Yeah, no. I got it. I got it. I get you now. Now, jetpacks. Diz lose more of his back camps. Waldemar, though, taking a lot of damage.
Spitfire would do it, but jetpacks just barely able to get the heal. Fan the Flames can't find the kill. That was extremely close, though. Waldemar's got to be careful about overextending.
Certainly does. But he gets the turret. That was the point that I was trying to make. And even with the turret, still gold advantage in favor of G2. And it's due to all of this invading that is consistently coming out from Dark Potato. Always looking to steal away the enemy back camps. Consistently denying gold away from jetpacks. And just putting it onto Dark Potato is enabling G2 to consistently stay relevant in this game, even though they're losing these objectives. So, still very close game, very much what we expected from both these lineups. It is very much a rematch of the team of former winners of previous qualifiers, and it's the first time we've seen anyone really top a team secret as the Dragon's Breath comes out from Red X.
Oh, that's a big gauntlet as well. The pressure cooker is in full effect right now. G2 trying to find some kills. Jetpack's the first to go down. Gotta be careful here, though. Waldemar could maybe turn it around. Lots of damage on to Dingo. But look at Raph. Oh, the Spitfire nearly lands at the end there. Raph 29 barely able to get away. You can see from Waldemar's damage, though, that as we move forward here, he's gonna hit a pretty scary point not that far from now.
Well, he's already hitting that scary point. The biggest thing for me in that engagement was the fact that Raph didn't have his ultimate available to him yet. If he had, that additional bit of damage would have been enough to at least guarantee one kill for SK Gaming. And I just think that once Raph gets a little bit more relevant, these fights should start swinging in SK's way.
Yeah, potentially Jetpack's gonna pop his ultimate there. Verse of Judgment not landing onto Dark Potato, though. They can't stun him up for the kill. Speaking of Dark Potato, he's going to become a Shiver
Waldemar.
So, oh, he is actually pretty deep right now. I'm not sure about going that far without backup from your team. G2 able to find another kill. They're actually leading
Dark
in
Potato
kills
now.
5-3 right now. Dark Potato wants to get another one. Jex heals himself up, but the smite finds the kill. Raph 29, last member standing. Can Dingo and Dark Potato chase this one down? Dark doesn't have his slow available just yet, though. So he's going to struggle to chase this one up. They're just going to take the minion mine and the two kills from earlier. Maybe go for a turret up in the lane. Lots of momentum going in G2's favor right now.
Certainly is, and it all comes off the back of Waldemar pushing the lane after losing that initial fight that we covered what seemed like a millennia ago now. He tries to steal away some of the back camps to redeem the gold that they lost in that engagement. He ends up overstaying, he gives away his life, and then Dark Potato, knowing that Waldemar is not alive, feels that he can start being aggressive, and Dark Potato picks himself up another kill as well. But right now, G2, heavy momentum swing in their favor, and with this composition, they are utilizing their power spike. Shiver Steel completed for Dark Potato. Reddick's now finished that Frostburn, working towards the Broken Myth. They're going to be hitting mid-game power spikes very quickly, and this is the opportunity they have been looking for to really solidify their lead in this game.
Yeah, the question is, are they going to be able to do it? We've got very good scaling on both of these compositions, with Waldemar, of course, on the side of SK, and on the side of G2, we've got the Krolt as well as Scarf. So it's going to be interesting to see which one of these wins out. Goldmine should easily be taken by G2 here. The steal does not come through from SK. They might want to pick up a fight, though, and Dingo starts an engagement with that gauntlet. No one really taking damage just yet, but Reddix finds some space, gets some kite down. Dark Potato jumping right onto Waldemar, but he's kiting away. Sonic Zoom gets him out of range of that smite, and the turnaround is here. Two very quick kills picked up by SK.
Oh, Raph.
Wow. Pretty close.
Very close, yes, and this is what I was talking about, that ground slam coming out from Raph, able to turn it around, and this was what I was saying in the previous fight, as long as they had that ultimate available, then there was no reason why they didn't have that extra bit of damage, that extra bit of crowd control to actually win out a fight against this G2 composition, and it came out at the end, and it was just enough to enable SK to turn that fight around. But now you're starting to see how difficult it is for Dark Potato to get on top of Waldemar if he positions properly. So much mobility available, but he may be caught out of position right now.
Yeah, I mean, this happened earlier twice, I think, and now it's happened for the third time. Past a certain point, you need to just check yourself a little bit before you wreck yourself, because Waldemar has been overextending consistently from Hellsheart, lands very long range onto jetpacks. I don't know if Dark Potato can find it, though, with Raft 29 backing him up. Looks like Dark Potato is going to just back away for now. Gonna go for the camp.
He stole it with the smite. Pretty consistent with this theft that he's going right now for. And it is allowed here on the folds. You can't steal other people's items, but you can steal away their life, as well as their jungle. So, all within the rules, and it gives you gold. It actually rewards you for doing that. So,
Bangalore is a bad influence on our youngsters, man.
Ban video games. No, don't do that.
I'd be out of a job. I was gonna say, please, no.
I like my job, right? Anyway, swiftly moving back. Setting up for the flank. He's looking for the gauntlet.
Yeah, I don't know if he wants to go for it just yet, though. Redix is still, was still fairly far back. Just there, Dark Potato. Moving in now. He hasn't got from Hell's Heart for another 10 seconds, so I don't think there's too easy of an engage for G2. SK. That was quite a nice pickup for them. They didn't get punished at all for going for that turret. Dark Potato might try and punish Waldemar right now, though, but he's already outside of that gauntlet. The Dragon's Breath coming through, though. They want to turn this one around. Dark Potato very low on the health bar. Raft 29 could be in a tough spot, though. Redix has kited perfectly here. Jetpacks, he doesn't have the last attack. Oh, he finds it with the burn damage, but we've already got two members dead on the side of SK. G2 coming out ahead in that fight.
Just felt like Waldemar's positioning there wasn't the best. He dashed into Redix, which made it so easy for him to land those skill shots and get the damage down that he needed to really secure that teamfight victory for G2. But you're seeing how close these exchanges are. It's simple, minor positioning errors from both teams that's really dictating who actually comes out ahead in the exchange. And that's why we have these two teams in the final. Very evenly matched, very back and forth, and very, very tense. For G2, all they need to do is consistently shut down Waldemar, because he's pretty much all of the damage for SK. But SK, they just need to consistently kite around. They have to keep Waldemar alive and allow him to shut down the front line while avoiding damage himself. So you can clearly see that for SK, their win conditions are a lot harder to execute, but they're so much more rewarding if they're able to execute it properly.
All right, we've got the Kraken spawning now. We've hit that 15-minute mark. This is when the fights become very punishing to lose, because you have such a big objective you can take off of the back of them. Right now, G2 sitting at a 2.6 or so K lead. Actually, slightly more than that. Decent lead for the side of G2. The question is, can they maintain it? One fight could change the course of things in a big way. Dingo actually starting up the Kraken already. Got some good damage here. Waldemar and... whoa, jetpacks. They have no idea that this Kraken is going on. G2, they're going to get this for free.
What it looks to me like is they want to try and shove the minion wave in as far as possible, which makes it harder for G2 to set up the siege.
Oh,
but man. G2 just don't care.
Jetpacks, I mean, that was not good for SK. I don't care what they're trying to do. I can appreciate that they didn't want the wave there. Look at the Dragon's Breath damage. Fan the Flames finds another kill. Waldemar's the only one left alive. That was mind-blowing.
Well, G2 had the vision that they needed to secure that. They have the Scarf plus a Crawl, so you're naturally going to take the Kraken very, very quickly. SK didn't respect that. They weren't in a position to really contest, and they end up giving away the Kraken. They try to make a play, but it's not enough. Waldemar now getting collapsed on.
He finds the reflex block on from Hell's Heart, but it's not going to be enough. Jetpack's also very low, can't get back to the platform. Raph finds one return kill onto Dark Potato, but look at the Kraken health. Still extremely full, over 75%, in fact. I think this might be a game-ending push for G2. They're going to bring this series to 1-1.
They certainly are. G2 want to demonstrate that they can put up a fight. And once again, we have a very close game, but Raph doing what he can to try and prevent this final game siege.
I can't see them being able to kill the Kraken quickly enough, especially with Dingo also bashing onto the Vayne Crystal. It would be an absolute miracle for SK to defend this one. Look at how low the crystal is. No, they're not going to be able to do it. G2 tying things up with an impressive game too.
Certainly was. G2 this time able to capitalize on the mistakes of SK and successfully come out ahead in a number of teamfights, which enabled them to secure those objectives necessary to win out the game. It felt very close, it felt very tense, but it was simply a matter of G2 being the better team in this game. They just, their teamfight presence was stronger, and it was, their execution was easier. Their win conditions were so much easier to capitalize on than SK's, that SK needed to be playing perfectly in order to win this game out. And it was simply a matter of that they weren't. They made a couple positional errors, they got caught out, their early game was a little bit all over the place, playing way more aggressive than they should have been, and they end up paying the price. End up equalizing the score 1-1 now by G2, and we have a best of five series on our hand.
Yeah, I mean, it could go to all five games, or it could go to four still. That is possible. I'm curious to hear what Humanist and Rome have to say about this one, because again, felt very close at times, but a few key mistakes sealed the deal, and I want to know what's going to happen moving forwards. Guys, talk us through it.
All right, well, G2 able to secure match number two there in a pretty convincing fashion. It looked like SK, you know, they had ability to win some fights there. They strung a couple together, but it just really didn't work out for them. Once they would lose one hero, the whole composition seemed like it just kind of fell apart. Rome, can you break it down for us? Walk us through like how it went for G2 to pull that out.
Well, first I'd like to note that we are tied 1-1. And, well, looking at that first game, just the first game in general and where SK won, I think had G2 grabbed a Ringo there, they would have done a lot better. In the second game, I think instead of going with that Vox, grabbing a Black Feather gives him a better opportunity to dive into that back line. So overall, like, I think it's this, the match between these two teams actually start during the drafting phase.
Yeah.
And I think they need to take a more closer look into their approach. G2, last game, they grabbed pretty much their core signature composition in terms of that Scarf, that Kroll, and they executed it so well. And this is something that both of the teams have to take into the third game. Either they're running a composition that they feel is very effective against the other team instead of a composition that they feel overall is strong on their behalf.
Yeah, definitely. They will have to think about that going into the game. And, you know, we saw some pretty strong performances out of Reddix, out of Dark Potato. Did you want to highlight any of them before, you know, we get into thinking about match number three?
Yeah, I think Dark Potato is somebody that we should take a look at this next match. Just mainly to the fact that he has all that jungle pressure and he is able to make a lot of plays. As long as he does grab something that's very effective against the other team, I'm positive that he can execute it out. As to like him grabbing a comfort pick or him playing something he's very, really good at,
yeah,
that does make a difference, but in general, you're going against a top dog. You're going against one of the best teams in the European scene. You have to be able to get an advantage against their composition.
Yeah, from my point of view, I like how Dark Potato, he's a very aggressive player, but he's using that aggression like to his team's benefit in team fights specifically. Like he's jumping in there to the back lines. He's getting on Vox very well. And then just getting back when he needed to be. But when he is dying, like they're getting objectives out of it. You know, he's not just dying for no reason. And you know, like also thinking about that last fight a couple times, and I feel like Waldemar was trying to do a lot of work because he felt pressure to do that. Do you think that he needed to be that far forward doing like those back camps and stuff when he got picked off there a couple times?
Well, the thing with him that last game was they pushed a lot into a hyper carry. In terms of every time you're grabbing a composition that's based on buffing coming out of the Adagio, you do have to put into retrospect that you are the core behind that team. You are the main damage dealer.
Yeah.
So playing as a Vox, you have to make sure that your positioning is always right. As long as you don't die, it doesn't matter like how long the fight takes because you benefit more in the long run.
Yeah, so maybe a little bit questionable. You wouldn't have done it. But Waldemar off, you know, he definitely thought that he needed to get it done. But hindsight's 20/20. But going into game three, you know, we've talked about these drafts, these strategies. SK win match number one with a Scarf Cruel combo. Match number two won by G2 with the same combo. Of course, you know, different support. But You know, I think we're ready for draft number three, so only time will tell, guys. We'll go ahead and get this draft underway, bring that up right now, and I do believe SK will have first ban in this draft. Yeah, they do. So going forward, what do they take away from G2 Kingwin, and is your money on them trying to pick up that Cruel Scarf combo again?
Definitely. I'm not too sure that they can secure both of them. But most likely, they will either grab that Cruel or they will grab that Scarf.
Which will be first? Would it be the Cruel?
Most likely, it will be that Cruel. Just because European teams do have like one of their major strengths is playing into that late game, getting those passive comps, and Cruel is the prime example of this. And we've seen the damage that he's dealt. Early game, he's fairly decent. He is able to win team fights as long as you're positioning yourself properly, as long as you're waiting for the enemy, like especially in a hidden brush. And that's where like this really comes forward. If you're a later scaling comp and your power spikes hit a lot later, but you gain that early game advantage, you're actually taking a much bigger step forward than you really need.
Yeah, definitely. And Cruel, the first pickup, immediately answered by Scarf Arden combo here, so it totally makes sense that they picked that up. And we're gonna see how SK want to round out this composition now that Scarf's been taken away. What do you think, that they go for some sort of different laner, or are they gonna pick up a mage in that lane? How do you approach this?
So Waldemar is previously known as best Celeste EU.
Ooh.
And this would be the perfect time for him to really step it up. Grabbing a Celeste, grabbing a Catherine on their end would make their composition really strong in general, and I think this gives them a really good balance. They just have to play that early game very slow.
Yeah.
Just due to the fact that if they do grab a mage in that lane, she's not going to be able to come down and help Cruel out at all.
Yeah, definitely something they'll have to weigh in here as they look for this last pick. And man, I'm kind of curious to see how this is going to work out, because they really could go a couple different directions here with this last pick. But yeah, like you said, it's probably going to be Waldemar's hero. Will it be the Celeste? Will it be something else? 2-1. Jewel, are you kidding me? Okay, so this is going to be a fun game. We were just talking about how we haven't seen a lot of her.
I'm actually stoked to see Jewel, just due to the fact that I am one of the people that really pushed forward for a crystal-powered Jewel.
Yeah.
The ultimates and the way that you're using your skills is just very nice to look at, and it's highly effective. But with the Sky coming out as the last pick for G2 Kingwin, they have a great chance in dodging out this Jewel. So what SK Prometheus has to do this match is they have to single out and try and take out Red X first. And if they fail to do this, I think Sky is going to unload all her skills on them.
Yeah, I mean, if given the opportunity, I imagine she would. That Catherine into the Jewel stun is a nice combo as well. The stun into the big red button, very easy to land. Yeah, we'll see how it's all going to play out, guys. We've loaded into the Halcyon Fold, and with that, we'll toss it to our casters. Action Jackson and Vedius, take it away.
Thank you very much, guys. This is going to be the third game of the series. It's 1-1 right now. Nail-biting games, both of those two. I'm interested to see which of these teams is going to be able to take it away. Some picks we're seeing that we haven't seen a great deal here, Vedius. At least in this qualifier, Jewel has not been seen very much. To be honest, Sky hasn't been seen a lot moving up to this point. So interesting that we're seeing lots of that in the finals.
Well, we did see Sky in game one being played very nicely by Red X. And it didn't quite work out for G2. So they're going to be trying once again here in game three to see if they can change things up. Now, in this duel, we actually saw it played by Team Secret yesterday. And it had sort of mixed success. It was doing very well in the early game, but then come to the mid to late stages, there were a lot of stuns being missed, some mispositioning, it wasn't being optimized properly. So here in Europe, I'm yet to see a Jewel really impress me. So I'm looking forward to seeing whether or not SK can change my opinion of that. I do expect it, as you heard from Rome, to be that Crystal Power Jewel, who has a lot of damage with the big red button, so positioning is going to be very important in this game for SK Game.
Yeah, I love that Crystal Power Jewel, man. One of the first things I played when I downloaded Vainglory, actually, just because there's nothing more satisfying than annihilating three people with one big red button.
Yeah, I'm just trying to think of all the other heroes. Multi-man Valkyries from Rhyme is pretty satisfying.
It's not as satisfying, though.
The outplays.
You can literally feel the big red button when you cast it, because it, like, knocks your character back and stuff. It's awesome.
I quite like... Oh, hang on, Dingo being caught out.
He's being chased here, but I don't know if it's going to be enough. Jumps away. Oh, the smite very close to picking up that kill. Now Jetpacks needs to run out of here because we got Reddix rotating down from the lane. The goop doesn't land onto him, but I don't think it's going to matter. Dark Potato has the damage. Dingo still in a bit of a tough spot up here against Raf 29, but they are going to be able to get him out of there. Actually just using him to bait in for Dark Potato right now. Raf 29 falls for it. Look at the damage coming through right now. Potato could probably pick this one up. Raf tries to juke away, can't do it. It's two quick kills for G2.
Ah, Potato just potatoing in his jungle, picking up two easy kills in the early game, and doing exactly what G2 did at the start of their last game, where using that Sky in the early game advantage, punishing the over-aggression that's coming out from SK, secures them a very small, but a gold advantage nonetheless in this first part of the map.
You know, Vettius, I have a sad announcement to make. I'm out of
potato
puns.
That doesn't sound great.
I'm out of potato puns. I've used all the ammunition that I have.
Yeah, but I'm pretty much...
There is a redeeming factor here, which is I still have potato jokes. What do you call a lazy kangaroo?
What do you call a lazy kangaroo? I don't know.
A pouch potato.
All right, that wasn't bad. We're gonna save those for the next game, though. That's
I got
potato jokes
for the finals.
Game,
I don't know what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna have to start reusing old material.
Yeah, my favorite potato pun was weapon of mass destruction. That's still by far my favorite.
I don't know. I liked going yam.
Going yam, not bad. Not bad at all. I imagine that Twitch chat at the moment is just like, please no, no more. It's all right, guys, we're out of potato puns, so we're going to stop with that. Let's jump back into the game. Let's have a quick recap. G2, they're going to be stealing away some of the enemy camps as Reddix doing what he can to prevent the theft of his own camps by throwing those Spitfires out. Throwing out the goop as well and having a look at the farm. Reddix and Waldemar in particular doing very nicely with this duel in the early game, but G2 need to be careful now. It's 3v2 down in the jungle.
It is indeed. Waldemar looking for something here. Might jump in with the stun. Has a lot of damage on that B ability, wrecking Dingo's health bar, but he's going to have to jump back to the safety of his turret. We got all three members from G2 up in this lane right now. Invasion of the jungle coming through from SK. They got to be careful. Dark Potato has so much damage right now. We saw it earlier. He can wipe through pretty much anyone's health bars.
Certainly does. The Reddix now needs to be the one and careful.
Yeah, we can see he's in a bit of a tough spot here, trying to get around. He's going to be the first to go down. Jetpacks picks that one up, but Dark Potato finds a full forward barrage onto several members. Waldemar, now the one that needs to run away. Raf actually baiting in, though, goes for the stun onto Dark Potato, but Jetpacks immediately falls forward barrage.
Oh, Waldemar!
Doing way too much damage. Waldemar! Oh, man.
He's done it again.
Every time.
Every time. It's the Waldemar special. That's what that is. Hey, man. Again, haters gonna hate. Potato's gonna potate. And it looks like that the entire SK lineup know how to potate as Raf now overextending in his jungle.
Oh, Dark Potato's in a bad spot. That's the stun coming down from Waldemar. Immediate pop onto Dark Potato. He got bounced between crowd control like a hot potato there.
He certainly did. The rocket jump securing the stun from Waldemar. Then you have the secondary stun coming up from Raf. And then Jetpacks just doing the damage that needed to be done to secure that kill. So, well executed by SK to punish the over-aggression coming out from G2. But still, again, very back and forth game. No clear advantage gained for either team so far. And it's simply due to both teams gain an advantage. They feel a little bit confident. They feel that they can start to make those plays. They overextend, and then they get heavily punished. Now Reddix, he picks up the Frostburn, but at what cost?
Oh, that's just so much damage going down onto Jetpack. Surrey Strike doesn't quite finish it off, though. Reddix, he's got to kite back a little bit, but now he can turn with the big red button. Coming through from Waldemar, doing a lot of damage, but not enough. Look at this. Dingo doing a beautiful job of keeping Reddix alive with that Vanguard. They are going to be able to find two quick kills and the gold mine off the back.
So you can see the damage that Waldemar can do right now with the big red button, with the thunder strikes. Assuming that he can land those skill shots, he's able to really dish out the DPS. But G2 are doing such a good job of kiting around and moving, but they might not be able to kite out of this one.
Yeah, it's going to be a tough sell. That said, Dark Potato with a lot of movement speed boosted up by Dingo find some distance. Can he get a cheeky recall here? Oh, no! Oh, man. If he just played chicken there, he would have been able to get away because Waldemar didn't actually use it in the bush, but he canceled his own recall. Dark Potato is going to go down. That's two return kills for the side of SK.
Looks like that, unfortunately for Dark Potato, he doesn't know how to do a Waldemar special. So, nevertheless, nice pickup for SK. Again, back and forth, over-aggression coming out from G2. They try to steal away the healing camp, get punished for it. And it's just, both these teams need to respect the respawn timers, I feel, because it's just consistent back and forth with, we get a kill, you get a kill, we get a kill, you get a kill. But I feel the big thing is all about these jungle camps and whether or not you can take them away in the early game, because the amount of gold and experience that you can deny by securing these jungle monsters is absolutely massive. So I do understand why G2 are moving in to take away these objectives, but they're just getting punished so hard without even being able to secure any.
Yeah, they've got to be careful not to over-aggress and reach a bit too far. That said, I do feel like Dark Potato's damage is pretty crazy right now, and if they can just get the kite that they need, they can turn it around. Whoa, look in the lane though, Reddix gets dove big time. That's what happens when Waldemar and Jetpacks have the ability to jump on you. Dark Potato gonna be the next target for Jetpacks. He gets stunned up by RAF 29, trying to Surrey Strike away. That's Death from Above, buying a little bit of time. He's got such a small amount of health left, but RAF wants this one. That's gonna be picked up by the Blast Tremor. Finishes it up in style. Dingo, he's in a one versus one with Waldemar, but he's gonna back away, get to the safety of the turret, try and stop any kind of ace coming through. Jetpacks wants more though. Gauntlet burned defensively, the big red button not gonna do enough. Now we've got Reddix rotating back in. He actually might try and go into Waldemar right now. I don't know if he's got the speed even with that Vanguard. Dingo gonna be keeping Wrath in the fight. That's a scout trap popping on the two of them. Reddix going with the Spitfires. He's just not quite fast enough. Doesn't have boots for 30 seconds. So it's hard for him to get close enough to deal the damage. Jetpacks juking out. Misses the goop as well. Now we actually see Raph, kind of strangely, I gotta be honest, go back in at the end there. Easily
he sacrificed
picked up by
himself.
Dingo.
I think he sacrificed himself for Jetpacks there. He said, you know what, you're the jungler, you're the carry, we need you to stay alive, we need you to get that farm, and have a look now. Jetpacks immediately moves to his back camps, he's going to get the gold, he's going to get the experience, and that means that it's not going to be wasted. So, honorable sacrifice from Raph, dying for the cause right there. You've got to give mad props to that, as Dark Potato now going hyper-aggressive onto Waldemar.
Yeah, but it's blocked, well, the death from above is blocked by the reflex block of Waldemar, so he's able to be fairly safe just there. We're sitting at 6 kills for 6, so at least in that sense the game is very even. But actually G2 with a nice gold lead at the moment, even though they've been struggling in the last few fights at the very least.
They certainly have. G2 aren't quite grouped up or in a position yet to fight, and as I say that, they look for one in the jungle.
Yeah, and Jetpacks is in a tough spot. He sustains a decent amount with the smite, though. That's a scout trap getting popped. He's super low. Dark Potato is going to go down and trade for him, though. Both of the roamers picking up the kills. Reddix, on the other hand, very low in the lane. Can't do anything against Waldemar right now. Vanguard doesn't keep him healthy enough. The big red button doing a lot of damage, clearing out the wave at the very least. Waldemar, the reflex block, max shield because of his health. The gauntlet comes through. It actually stuns up Waldemar and finds the kill. Dingo, with the crazy Arden plays, manages to get 2 right at the end there. Very impressive stuff from him.
So you can see Dark Potato on this guy, easily able to kite out the Krull, and they're able to secure that kill down onto Jetpacks. But while all that action is going off, Reddix is completely cut off from the rest of G2, because he's in a 1 versus 1 against Waldemar, and Waldemar doing a great job of landing those Thunder Strikes, landing the Rocket Jump, and just guaranteeing the damage and preventing Reddix from really being involved, resulted in it being 1-for-1 overall. The fight continues on, Dingo being a hero, able to get a return kill with a beautiful gauntlet, ends up being 2-for-2 at the very end of that fight, but no major objectives gained. G2 still hold on to that 1,000 gold lead.
They do indeed, but are they going to be able to make anything happen with it? Still haven't picked up that outer turret. That said, neither has SK. The game is very even at the moment, and it has every single game in this series. You can ask for a better finals to very evenly matched teams. Right now, all three members of both sitting up in the lane, waiting for that opportunity to make something explosive happen.
Yeah, they're just setting up. They have the poke available to them from that scarf. Completed both the Eve of Harvest and the Frostburn. So going to be doing a fair amount of damage at this point. But have a look at the energy right now on Red X, burning through it so very quickly. And this could be the opportunity for SK to go for a fight.
Yeah, they're going to try and find it. There's a big red button. Oh, look at Red X melted. Crazy damage out of Waldemar. Dark Potato, he's silenced. He can't do any damage on the backside here. And that was just all Waldemar, baby. Massive big red button. Easily finds the kill onto Radix, and Dark Potato, because of the silence, just couldn't turn it around. Now they're going for the dive here. Another great stun out of Waldemar. Dingo trying to gauntlet out of this one defensively. Has to pop his own wall, though, in order to get away. Raft is going to be the good teammate, tank up the turret on the backside. But I imagine this is another goldmine going the way of SK.
All right, SK, you're starting to sell me on this Crystal Power Jewel, because that was phenomenal. You positioned properly, you can see why it's called the big red button, and that was so much damage down onto Reddix. He's still 0-4-6. Broken myth now completed for Waldemar, but G2, they want to try and get something back. SK immediately going to disengage, but what a well-executed fight from SK. This is what I was talking about. Reddix, super low on energy. He was pretty much on the front lines trying to get as much poke down as he could. So that was the opportunity that Waldemar was looking for to land the rocket jump, get the stun down, and then the rest of SK immediately collapsed to shut Reddix down and prevent him from once again being involved in these fights. And this is the way in which SK win this game, consistently preventing Reddix from being involved and allowing him to do his thing. Whoa. As he uses the Dragon's Breath.
Lots of damage onto Waldemar. The Ford Barrage finds that kill. Dark Potato is very far away from the engagement of SK, but they somehow managed to get there with the speed boost on Wrath. Now Dingo is going to be just body blocking a little bit, keeping Dark Potato safe. Good call by Reddix, actually, to use the Dragon's Breath there, even though it was very deep to get the kill. Wrath 29 trying to block as much as he can here on that turret, but he goes down for it. Dark Potato coming out of nowhere with some big damage. Very nice work by him.
That was so good on so many levels from so many different players from G2. As you rightly said, Reddix realizing the damage that his Dragon's Breath had, and Waldemar did not. But on top of that, Waldemar used his rocket jump earlier on to help clear the wave, so Reddix could guarantee that he would get that damage down, especially with the Frostburn he had available to him. Dark Potato cleans that kill up. And then Dark Potato follows up with a beautiful death from above, cutting off the escape from Wrath and guaranteeing a second kill alongside the turret to give G2 the gold lead back in this game. Really well played stuff and great decision making coming out from G2 in that small exchange.
Indeed it was. The kills are 10 for 10 right now, and we're still within close to 1,000 gold between the two teams. Could not be closer at this stage in the game. Kraken spawning in 1 second now. So, with Minion Mine being picked up by G2, they're going to be in a decent spot here. But look at Dark Potato's health. A little bit low for them to do anything too aggressive. The jetpack's all the way back in base, though. Maybe they can get some good vision down, something like that. I would like to see more vision coming out of G2, actually. That's one thing I feel like they're lacking a little bit here.
As you say that, Dingo, very quickly dropping down those scout traps. They know now, with the Kraken being alive and with the composition that SK have, it could very quickly go down. As you say that, look at all the scout traps that have now been put down. Is that enough vision for you, AJ?
They were listening to me, all right? That must have been what happened. It's all me.
Yeah, all you, man. All you, definitely. They just want to repay you for all the great potato puns, you see? They're just like, you know what? Let's listen to him. Let's just help him out. Give him that vision that he so desperately wants. Flare's going to spot that vision out, though. So that's going to be quickly removed by Wrath.
Yeah, Raph easily able to clear at least a few of those scout traps. Dark Potato has since gone back to base and healed up a little bit, so if they want to fight, maybe they can find something here. Just got to be careful about that big red button just obliterating someone instantly again. Raph goes for the engage, finds a stun onto Reddix. There's a jump from Waldemar as well. He wants to go into Dark Potato. Waldemar's got to back away here, finds two people with the big red button. Whoa, Reddix. Man, he got obliterated. Dark Potato, he's trying desperately to put down the damage, but he's got to run away at some point. He can't be too aggressive right now, or can he? Finds one onto Wrath. Dingo in the 1v1 with Waldemar. I mean, whoa, what is his health right now? It's got to be almost nothing. Jetpacks goes down. Dark Potato, he's still up. Oh, Waldemar, he gets it. He turns Dark Potato into a powdered potato. That's going to be the ace.
Oh, man, what a great team fight. That was so fun to watch. SK Gaming initially are the ones to go for the engage. You saw Wrath land the primary stun onto Reddix, and at that point you think, oh, Reddix is going to very quickly reflex block that. He also has the Crucible coming out from Dingo. He's going to be fine, and things are looking good. He's running down the alley, starting to kite back Jetpack, but then the out-of-nowhere ultimate comes out from Waldemar. Reddix has nothing left. All the reflex blocks, all the defensive items are used, and he just gets eviscerated, and then with Reddix gone, Dark Potato does a good job to get two kills back thanks to his brilliant maneuverability, but then Waldemar in the 1v1 has the vision advantage, ends up winning that team fight for SK Gaming. Super crazy game, very back and forth, and this is the sort of final we were hoping for here in Europe.
Yep, I mean, that was crazy. The big red button is doing so much work in these fights. He found it across two people. That's really what made it work. Blast Tremor comes through. Big stun. Oh, what a massive big red button coming through. Reddix, I don't even see him trying to fight this one. There is nothing he can do with Dark Potato dead. Look at the smite coming out of Jetpacks. Big damage there. Waldemar chasing down onto Dingo. Stops that recall, not letting him pull a Waldemar. And he finds the kill. It's another ace for SA. They just keep these fights coming.
They certainly do, and SK now realize we shouldn't be putting all our effort into shutting down Reddix. Let's try and delete Dark Potato. The stun goes down onto him, massive big red button, combine that with the From Hell's Heart, just sets up for such a beautiful engagement and deletion that came out from Waldemar. Brilliant execution, beautiful use of the big red button, and SK are in full control of this game.
They are indeed. It was very even for a very long time, but the last few fights certainly have looked good for them. Waldemar doing a lot of work. Going to be trying to go for this Kraken right now, find it for themselves. That was a little bit sketchy, actually. SK almost let that one heal back up, but Waldemar sweeps in and saves the day. Not a huge gold lead, but four kills ahead and with the Kraken, I imagine SK are going to be looking for a big push here.
Well, look at Waldemar. Broken Myth, Shatter Glass, he's also got the Clockwork, he's also got the Frostburn, he is basically full build. The only thing he hasn't upgraded is boots. He has gone all out on the damage, he wants to just delete G2 off the map, and he's going to be looking to do that as they try to crack the base of G2.
That's the Blast Tremor popped by Wrath. They're trying to go in here. From Hell's Heart lands onto Dark Tato. Waldemar might have jumped a little bit too far. He knocks himself onto the turret with the big red button. Oh my word. Now Reddix looking for the turnaround here. Big damage onto Jetpacks, but he's healing a lot of it back up. Not enough though. Kraken finds a turret, but Wrath needs to leave. Guys, I love Crystal Power Jewel. Do not get me wrong, but I'm an advocate for sensible big red buttoning. Do not knock yourself back into their base, come on!
Oh man, that was a what not to do with Jewel. Throughout this game, we've seen, this is how you set up for Jewel, this is how you use the big red button, this is exactly how you need to play it, and then Waldemar was like, oh right, let me show you what you shouldn't do, and that's ult yourself onto the base. But still, massive style points awarded to Waldemar. I think he can add that to his list of Waldemar specials. I mean, yeah, at this rate, he's going to have a pretty long list of the number of plays that he's been making throughout this series.
He really is. You could pretty much make a montage out of all of his plays from this series, and it would be a good montage.
Both good,
right?
And bad, yeah.
But you could also make a parody montage.
Yeah. Dingo has been spotted out by SK.
He has indeed. That's going to be the gauntlet popped. Blast Tremor goes through, though. Now I can see Waldemar going forward. That's a big red button, but it only lands about half of the duration onto the key targets. Jetpacks locks up Dingo. There's another jump forward. Waldemar taking a lot of damage. Ooh. So Reddix turning this fight around. Jetpacks is in a tough spot as well, trying to get the kill onto Dingo. He's got the reflex block. He wants to smite, but he can't find it. Needed 2 more seconds for that cooldown to come back up. G2 with a really big series of turnaround fights. If they win this game, Waldemar is going to get so much flack. So much.
Oh no, this is really big for G2. I don't think that SK realized that the shutdowns that G2 were able to pick up off of the back of getting those kills, as well as the Kraken. Urden spikes for G2. Not only that, you know, if you just have a look at the double Aegis that was picked up for both Reddix and Dark Potato, that's a lot of extra shield they now have available to them. and their positioning in that fight was on point. You saw Dinger on the backside, keeping a little bit of interference, preventing SK from really getting the optimal setup. And then Dark Potato and Reddix very quickly disengage to then reposition and then set up for the beautiful three-man Dragon's Breath coming out from Reddix. Just great setup. Reddix gets himself a number of kills, and all of a sudden G2 looking strong contenders coming back into this game.
It's all going to be about this next crack, and it has already respawned. You can see both teams posturing around it. Dingo going to pop his bit of a speed boost there just to make some distance. Actually, with Dark Potato back in base and SK starting off this crack, and this could be bad for G2. It would be a second time where they haven't really reacted to it on time. Reddix trying to move in now, though. Look at the big red button. Wipes out his health. Dingo even catches a little bit of that damage. Dark Potato wants to keep this fight going, but the stuns keep on coming from Waldemar. He's so much cooldown reduction. This is bad news for G2. Off the back of two very encouraging fights, I guess you could say. They are now in a tough spot. They have delayed the Kraken, but I don't know if it's going to be enough. Dark Potato should be able to get out of here. I don't know if Waldemar can close this distance when he's burning through a lot of the energy. He actually gets locked up there. Dark Potato doing some good return damage, but it's not going to be enough. We've only got Dingo left alive, and he's being chased forward by jetpacks. The smite comes through. It's another ace for SK. This is a quick and easy Kraken for them to pick up.
It was looking so good for G2 to start coming back into the game, but then all of a sudden, just the engage coming out from Waldemar. They knew that G2 would try and contest the Kraken with no hesitation. Waldemar goes in for the stun. The From Hell's Heart comes out from jetpacks, locking down Reddix, and they just pop him. There's no way he's going to get out from that that combination of ultimates. Then with the numbers advantage, it's just cleanup for SK. They get themselves the Kraken, still behind in gold, though. And we could see another comeback fight coming out from G2. Those death timers aren't that long.
Yeah, I mean, it's really going to be all about Waldemar and his ultimate. Not just in the sense that he needs to hit a lot of people with it, but he needs to not hit himself with it.
Yeah. It's a big red button on a big red I'm going to kill myself button. And I don't know where I was going with that. Reddix
now. It's like in the movie, you know, when there's the big red button and they're like, do not press this button. Do not press this button. We will all die if you press this button. Waldemar's like, I wonder what this button does.
Death from above comes out from Dark Potato.
Shot from Hell's Heart out of jetpacks, not land onto anyone there, but the Kraken's still very healthy, knocking away on these turrets. Waldemar, you know he's going to be looking for a big red button in just a second. Everyone's grouped up. Can he find it? Has to leap away from that Dragon's Breath first. Here it comes. Doesn't really land onto anyone, but the Kraken's still wiping through the Van Crystal. It is going to be SK taking it down and taking away game three. Very intense game between these two teams.
It certainly was. At the end there, people may have been confused as to what he was doing with that ultimate. He actually used it to guarantee the destruction of the Vein Crystal. Remember that abilities will hit through onto objectives and structures here in Vainglory. So using all the damage that he had available, and he definitely had a lot of it, it was a quick and easy way to end the game for SK. So what looked so much closer between the two teams, very back and forth, almost a bit of a throw coming out from SK, they are able to secure and SK lead the series now 2-1. But it was, this was a stupidly fun game to watch, and this Crystal Power duel is definitely growing on.
I like big red buttons, and I cannot lie, all you Ardens are gonna die. He had so many good snipes in that game. And I'm curious to see if we're gonna see any more of the Crystal Power duel moving forwards. Humanist and Rome, what do you think? Are we gonna see any more of that, or is it not gonna be allowed through moving forwards?
Well, stupidly fun. I think that's an apt description of that match right there. SK taking the advantage here in the series up 2-1. And what a fun game, Rome. I mean, we haven't seen a lot of Jewel, but Waldemar pulls her out and just absolutely dominating performance. Huge big red buttons, really awesome rocket leaps, and just all around. I mean, it was a great game back and forth. So G2, they played their part in that. Fun engagements. But at the end of the day, SK do close that out. From your perspective, how did it play out? And was it the compositions? Was it the way that they played the composition? And was it as fun for you to watch? Because I had fun.
It was definitely fun to watch. And overall, I think it was how SK Prometheus was were able to sync up their abilities. And in turn, you have triple stun coming out of everybody on that team in terms of their composition and the way that they're approaching it. all we saw as for the defensive itemizations coming out of the G2 side, everybody did have like a reflex block of some sort and a crucible, but it was not enough. And every time, like Jewel, we don't see her being played that often. And maybe is their approach to this, or maybe like they don't know how to avoid it. But time and time over again, that last match, that big red button just took out everybody.
Yeah, just massive, massive big red button. And it's so much fun to watch. I think it's probably one of the coolest spells in the game, or one of my favorites anyway. But yeah, guys, that was just game number 3. This is a best of 5, so we have more matches coming your way. Can SK close it out in the next match, or can G2 push it to game 5? We'll find out very shortly. We're going to take a quick break for these players, but don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Ben, Sam, and Ken are on separate journeys to defeat the menacing Vile Dragon. But let's just say luck isn't on their side. If only there was a way for them to find each other and band together. Well, that's why there's Band. It's a mobile app that allows people to come together using common interests. With Band, you can find fellow gamers, chat, schedule gaming sessions, and conduct polls. Stage epic battles with friends while sharing videos and photos along the way. So try Band today. Band. Be together.
Shatter the Vein, a podcast about vainglory.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, as we quickly approach our match 4 here in this finals matchup of our Europe division. And man, it has been a fun series so far. Rome predicting that G2 is going to take this series, and I mean, they can still do it, but I'm pretty happy with the way SK has been playing this out so far. Really fun to watch both of these teams pull out these compositions and play them as well as they are. But, you know, when we look especially at the last game, we do highlight players, and I definitely think that we need to highlight Waldemar a little bit here. Because this is a guy that like makes me think of like certain heroes, or when I see a hero, I think of this guy. Like Petal, when I think of Saw, I'm thinking Waldemar. And now, strictly, I mean, when I think Jewel, I'm gonna be thinking Waldemar, because like that was just awesome. So let's talk about him a little bit. What do you think makes this guy so special, and how does he stack up with his competition?
It's just his overall knowledge of the game, and when I look at Waldemar, I see one of the players that is very engaging. He has the confidence in himself to really put himself out there. Although there like are several times that he does get punished for it, in general, like this is a very good approach for them. Considering the way that they play in their compositions that they build, tending and relying more on those passive to late game compositions, Waldemar really like suits their strong needs in this scenario. And like coming up with this next game, they have a chance to take it out since they are leading 2-1.
Yeah.
And I'm almost certain that Waldemar will be landing a scarf. So we'll be seeing great plays coming out of him, and how he positions himself will really show us later on.
Yeah, so it'll actually be, I could be wrong, but I think G2 has the first ban coming up here. So we'll see how it all works out. Do they take that away from Waldemar? But we can see that, you know, he can play on a lot of different roles. One of the moments that really stood out for me was that big team fight they had right in the middle of the jungle there, and it came down to just last man standing, Waldemar, and he takes the fight. But it was amazing to watch that all play out. And I thought like he killed one person. It started with the big red button. They eliminated Reddix, but then it was a drawn out fight, and he was on just a sliver of health. Like he had no life, and he just fights through it. And so many players you see, they're like, oh, I'm done. You know, and they give up, but he fought through it. I mean, you expected that?
And that comes down to experience and how much confidence you have, really. A lot of the players, like, if they know their hero limitations, they know, like, to the extent that they can fight it out and how far they can actually bring it. And this is probably, like, one of the best things to watch. Like, I know in many situations before where I'll be playing the roamer position and my carry is just trying to fight like 1v3. I'm like, see you later. And, you know, like, I'll take a couple steps away before I turn back and realize that, you know, we actually have a chance to win this team fight.
Yeah.
And had I stayed there and made that, like, extra benefit in terms of supporting my carry,
yeah,
things would have gone, like, a totally different way.
Yeah, it's a really funny experience, but only, you know, just practice, getting to know, and, of course, communication with your team. Allows them to do all of those wonderful things. So yeah, it's not just the Waldemar show, but he did highlight himself there in that last match. But guys, we have draft ready for match number four coming up here, and man, we're gonna find out, can SK secure this series? You know, can G2 come back and push this to match number five? You know, I really think it could go to the full series, but SK, they've been playing, you know, very well, so only time will tell. Fortress the ban out here by G2 and SK. They're going to look to respond.
Yeah, and I feel here in this position, they might ban out an Adagio, but primarily, like, looking the way that it's going to go, G2 Kinguin is going to pick up one of their picks first. And with Krul being banned out, Scarf has to be, like, that number one go-to hero.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, especially with these two teams. Okay, so that leaves the Adagio in the pool. Do you think that they pick up this Adagio and build around it?
Yeah, and this is actually a good, like, chance for them to come back to the second game where the SK Prometheus team lost. Grabbing an Adagio here is great, but they have to focus. They need a composition that is able to dive very strong.
Where you were talking about the Black Feather before.
Yeah, and the Black Feather fits in so well here. And it's not just that. You have so many options in terms of either grabbing a Sky or grabbing a Koshka. As long as they're able to dive to that back line, it puts Scarf in a very vulnerable position.
Well, they don't go with the Adagio here, and it's Catherine as the first pick, although we do still have room to pick up that Adagio, go for that kind of buff comp. Not a full buff, but, I mean, Catherine used to kind of peel people off in that scenario. 15 seconds coming up here. What do you think, Rome? If you had to predict, you've got to call it right now. What's it going to be?
I would call a Black Feather.
Black Feather as second pick?
Or hold it for actually, no, I'll take a Sky.
Take Sky right now. They need mobility. Koshka. Okay, I mean.
That works too.
Yeah, definitely. I didn't mention the Koshka, but we've seen her used to great effect, paired up with different roams from time to time. But this is a strong combo. Stun out of your Catherine, stun out of your Koshka. And of course, like you, I mean, you're talking about Black Feather. I think that would plug in there great. We'll just have to wait and see. How did G2 answer this? Arden.
And so here you can see Dark Potato already, like, folding back towards his comfort pick in terms of grabbing up that Glaive. And we've seen the potential out of Dark Potato before. And to be honest, this time Glaive actually fits in a lot better with that Scarf, considering you do have that afterburn for the peel and making sure Scarf is able to live longer. SK Prometheus here, though, what are they going to choose? They actually have a great initiation in terms of going in after Catherine's ultimate when everybody is silenced. Koshka can pretty much automatically land that ultimate and nobody can crucible it. Grabbing that Black Feather last gives them an ultimate in terms of how they're all going to dive onto that person at the same time. As long as they coordinate this outright, I think they have a great chance to take out the win and finish up the series.
Oh man, I can't even wait for this game to start right here. SK do have the tools to jump onto that Scarf and blow him up before the fight really gets going. But of course, G2, they really have the tools to have an amazing team fight. And you put down that gauntlet, it allows Scarf to just get these guys all funneled up, easy kills. But guys, let's see if they can combo it up. We have loaded into the Halcyon Fold, and with that, we're going to toss it to our casters. Action Jackson, Vettius, take it away.
All right, thank you very much, Humanist and Rome. We're here for what could be the final game of the finals for the second winter qualifier. Vettius, it is going to be awesome.
It certainly is, but I'm a little bit upset, AJ.
Why is that?
The reason I'm upset is because for every single game, I have made a prediction that Black Feather would be in it. And the one game that I didn't predict the Black Feather, there is a Black Feather in the game. Like, why am I cursed? Why can't I make accurate predictions? It upsets me greatly. I try and I try, yet I just cannot predict anything, which is why I'm not going to predict who's going to win this game, because then all the fans of one team would just get angry at me.
You can't cop out now. This is what it all comes down to. I mean, one more win and SK get home. Now's the time.
No, I refuse. I can't carry that burden with me. The power that I hold to determine who will win is just such a great burden to bear.
Well,
I'm not going to do it.
I know that you've predicted someone in your heart of hearts, so it's probably already happened, even if you're not going to give voice to that prediction.
Alright, well anyway, going back to the game, we do have a Black Feather, so we're going to be having Jetpacks play that one. We have seen Jetpacks play this Black Feather in the past, in previous qualifiers, and he has demonstrated that he is one mechanical god. And when he gets the opportunity to run away with this Black Feather, he can run away with the games by himself. So, he is definitely one of my players to keep your eyes on. Waldemar playing Koshka. Looking for that early game presence, but so far throughout Europe especially, we have not been seeing very many successful Koshkas. Perhaps that could change now.
Yeah, they are going to be looking for Dark Potato here, but they don't really have enough damage yet. Jetpack's not hit his stride yet. Dark Potato easily able to afterburn away as well. The SK have their aggression checked a little bit. Meanwhile, Reddix just getting free farm up in the lane. No one's contesting him at all, so not a bad start for the side of G2.
Not a bad start at all. Slight gold advantage going over in favor of G2 right now as Reddix.
Yeah, I mean, that was going well, but then Reddix face checked a bush. SK, they got first blood, man.
Yes, they did. Looking great for SK, but you have to remember that in the early game, first bloods and stuff, they're not really the priority. Taking away back camps has a significantly larger impact than getting those first kills. Yes, you deny some experience, you get yourself a bit of gold, but in terms of what it actually contributes to, it's not that massive, especially considering how swingy both these teams have been. Very rarely have we seen one team take an early kill and run away with the game. Often you'll get that one kill, but then you'll hand it right back after in pretty much a minute's time.
Yeah, that is a very good point. And you can see the gold is dead even, basically, even off the back of that kill. Dark Potato looking to change that, though, coming in here onto Waldemar. Finds it with a crit there, so very nice work by him, not going down. Reddix as well, rotating down a little bit. He's doing a good job of harassing off Jetpacks, making Raph run away. They've evened up the kills one for one.
So, as I called it, you know, one team gets one kill, the other instantly answers back.
You're glossing over the fact called something. That's a big deal. You should be very happy with yourself.
I called it and predicting are two different things. Because this, I called it based on tendencies, whereas a prediction is when you make a basis off of... No, actually, they're pretty much the same thing.
I was trying to sort of understand where you were going with that.
Yeah, I'm like, no, I gotta be honest. I'm literally explaining the same thing twice. I don't... All right, well... I'm gonna quickly
forget that I don't know the English language. Yeah, you're Welsh,
Yeah, I learned Welsh first. It's a true story. So sometimes words are hard for me in English.
Is it just bah? Bah? Is that?
Wow. Low blow, my friend. Low blow. Anyway, quickly moving back to the game. Because this is important. We should take this more seriously. Because. It's very tense between these two teams. SK leading the series 2-1 right now. If they take this win, they're going to be taking first seed, and that's going to be massive when it comes to the live championships. The better you're seeding, the greater your chances are at making it to the semifinals and evidently the finals. So all these teams want to be doing well when it comes to that London live championships. And speaking of those London live championships, ladies and gentlemen, you can get tickets for those. They are not sold out yet, so if you want to come and see my beautiful face, see the magic behind the voice, make sure you do come on down because I will be there welcoming you in my home country.
Let's be real, though. That's not why people would come down.
It could be. People want to see the mystery man behind the voice. Oh, Raph goes to the engage.
Yeah, they're trying to pick onto Reddix right now, who is taking a lot of damage, but he's able to kite backwards. And Dark Potato with an afterburn onto Jetpacks might look to trade this one out. Jetpacks is going to go down. Very nice pickup for G2. They haven't lost anyone yet. Could be able to get some good pressure off the back of that counter gank.
Beautiful afterburn coming out from Dark Potato. That was such great use of it to wait for a lot of the disengage tools to be used by SK. And then as SK were looking to retreat, Dark Potato instantly goes in with the afterburn, sets up Jetpacks nicely for the rest of his team, and then get G2 earn themselves the kill advantage. So great plays by them to take advantage of this stronger early game that they have available to them.
Question is, can they keep it rolling, or are they going to fall flat a little bit later on? We've seen very close early and mid games between these teams pretty much every single game. SK just has been coming out ahead a little bit more frequently, trying to do the same thing in this final game and close it out without having to go to that final game, that blind pick, where anything could happen. Very difficult to control the environment when you're in a blind pick situation.
Yeah, just remember that these teams now will have had a lot of opportunity to identify their patterns, their play styles, their priority picks. And we saw from Team Secret yesterday, when they went into the blind pick, instantly they go for the Saw push comp. Hang on a second, Waldemar goes in.
Oh, this is a Dragon's Breath. It's going to be landing on several members here. Reddick's doing a lot of damage. Yummy Cat and Frenzy onto the backline, though Waldemar doesn't have the backup to make the play work. Wrath easily picked up there. Jetpacks knew he just needed to book it out. There's going to be two kills going the way of G2. They're going to be able to get the gold mine as well.
Very solid early game coming out from G2, executing these team fights insanely well right now. Chunking out jetpacks before he has an opportunity to do anything means that Waldemar and Wrath are pretty much left by themselves right from the start of the team fight. And Waldemar tries to go into the back line. He just doesn't have the damage, especially with the insanely early reflex block that came out from Reddix. Means that G2 have SK's number in this game 4.
They do so far, but again, we've seen this kind of thing before, and it just doesn't always go the way of the team pulling ahead in the early. That said, they are up against Waldemar's Kashka, which is something you would typically associate with the early game. So as we move later on, it might be hard for him to be very effective. We'll have to see. Jetpacks can certainly be a force to be reckoned with later on, though.
Yeah, the thing about Kashka for me is she just hasn't had the same sort of impact here in Europe that she's had in other regions. Especially in North America, she really has been able to make some pretty crazy plays, but Europe just not quite able to make use of this Kashka like they have been able to with their Krull. So interesting how these jetpacks...
Gonna be able to use Rose Offensive to get away just temporarily, but you can see big damage coming out of Dark Potato now, finds that kill with the critical strike. Waldemar wants to jump back in. I feel like that might be a little bit bold. Gonna be able to walk away though. Without jetpacks, there's very little damage on the side of SK Prometheus, right?
Yeah, he has that Serpent's Mask, but he's never really getting an opportunity to use it. Waldemar goes in regardless.
Yeah, does some nice damage onto jetpacks. Or sorry, onto Reddix. Gonna use the Yummy Cat in Frenzy, but it's not enough. You know, you don't have the follow-up from jetpacks to actually get a kill.
No, you don't. And it was a great reflex block coming out from Dark Potato to mitigate the crowd control that Waldemar tried to use. And now Waldemar needs to be very careful as Jetpacks has rejoined the fight.
Dingo very low here. That is a kill for SK. They might be able to get Dark Potato as well. He's able to get under the turret with the Afterburn, though. SK, I'm sure, will be very happy with that one, however, as it is their first kill picked up in quite some time.
Yeah, they are going to be quite happy off the back of that. You can see now, though, gold advantage still in G2, so Reddick's getting collapsed on.
Does a lot of damage to Jetpacks there, but he might have overextended. That's going to be another pickup onto him. Twice now in this game, he has gone down from extending a little bit too far in the lane. With him down, you can see the turret falling very quickly. Two members are low on the side of SK, though. They've got to be careful about overextending. Getting picked up by Dark Potato. Looks like they're going to be able to retreat and get out of here safely, though.
Just comes back to what you and I were talking about in some previous games when it comes to vision. And neither team really... controlling the vision, especially when it comes to these flanks and their own half of the map. You can see that G2 have put some deep wards down, but they haven't really put much focus on their defensive wards because they feel that they have been in control of the game so far and they got punished a little bit. Jetpacks, though, he takes a bit of punishment himself.
The gauntlet going down by Dingo. He had to use that one defensively, which is a first for this game. So you can see SK turning up the heat a little bit, are applying enough pressure to be a bit of a problem for the side of G2. That said, G2 were easily able to pick up a turret that was already weakened off the back of SK's retreat.
Goodbye.
Jetpack slammed into the wall by Dark Potato. That was a very strong play coming out from him. Easy pickup. Kill score 6-3 in favor of G2 off the back of that.
Bet he was wishing he had a jetpack to get himself out of that situation.
No.
Fortunately, Dark Potato slamming him into the wall. Very easy pickup for him. And good... objective focus. Ooh, Wrath tries to go for the steal, unable to get it.
That was pretty close, but I think he's going to go down for his troubles. I don't see Dingo and Dark Potato not being able to close. Oh, he does! Oh, I lied, kind of. That was a lot of heal coming through at the end, man. Very nice plays by Raf29.
He held on to that Fountain of Renewal for such a long time. It may have even been on cooldown. I didn't actually keep my eye on it, but regardless, popped it, kept himself alive. Great stuff from Raf, able to get out of that situation. And I mean, if you're going to go for a steal, that's a best case scenario for you. Walk in, try the steal, fail it, walk back out again.
Second best case scenario.
Okay, second best case.
Best case scenario would be getting the steal.
Yeah. It would be. You are correct.
Jetpacks just got chunked to half health off of one Spitfire. That's crazy. Reddix is very strong at the moment. He hasn't gone for the more defensive build, which I have to admit I like. I think it's better to go the one that he has gone. He's just picked up a Shatter Glass and an Eve of Harvest, so he has a lot of damage.
You like that deeps, do you? Like to go for the builds with all the deeps?
I do like going deeps, that is for sure.
Yeah, so Reddix right now. Going for the Shatter Glass, Eve of Harvest, as you stated, does mean that he has a lot of damage, but he might be looking to use that damage on Jetpacks, who identified his spidey senses were tingling there. He was like, I don't know where G2R, sorry. I'm just going to back out of that one. He's going to go back and buy. What is he going to be able to pick up? He has a lot of gold. He's actually just going to go for a little bit more defensive itemization. So he's got that kinetic shield, which makes a lot of sense given how aggressive Reddix has gone with this itemization.
Yeah, I think picking up early shield is definitely a good plan for the side of SK Prometheus. The question is it going to be enough? You can see Spitfire not doing too much to Raf there. He is fairly tanky, though. Dingo might be looking for a gauntlet here. He is hovering quite close to the members of SK. Jetpacks eating a few Spitfires. That shield really doing wonders there. Gauntlet goes down, not going to land onto anyone. Waldemar tries to jump on the backside, goes on to Reddix, doesn't find the stun, but there is a decent amount of damage there. Jetpacks, though, doesn't have enough to follow it through, and now Raf needs to retreat. First kill of that fight going the way of G2, and they look like they won't be stopping anytime soon, forcing the other members of SK Prometheus back.
So SK needed to focus down Reddix in that fight. And Waldemar, great initiation. He survived for such a huge amount of time, and he just stuck onto Reddix. But what G2 did was they used Dingo and Dark Potato to act as sort of a shield and a front line that made Jetpacks hesitant to follow up from that engage from Waldemar, which meant that SK didn't have the damage to shut down Reddix. Reddix was able to facilitate that enough. Dark Potato secures himself another kill, and then G2 come out ahead in another engagement. And it's just great positional play from G2, but then also a lack of confidence from SK to consistently follow up on these engagements.
Yeah, I have to admit that is a bit of an issue for them. Right now, the Dragon's Breath could be going across several members of SK. Looks like it might be falling a little bit short. Waldemar wants to jump on the back line. There's the Fountains of Renewal ticking away, but it's not going to be enough to save his life. Reddix is pretty low, but no one can get the final blows down onto him. Raf likely gonna fall, but I've said that once before. All right, this time he does actually go down, and an ace comes through for the side of G2. This is probably the most convincing lead we've seen from a team this early in this series.
It certainly is, and we're really starting to see the value of Scarf in this series in particular. It has been utilized by both teams phenomenally, and in that fight in particular, it looked like Reddix was out of position, but in fact, all of SK grouped up. Hang on, Waldemar, he takes a lot of damage.
Does indeed. Get down, though.
He is going to get out of that one. So just backtracking to what I was talking about earlier. Reddix grouping up in that jungle, able to get all of his area of effect damage off, combined with Dark Potato's area of effect damage. They just didn't care. G2 just clumped up, made it really difficult for SK, and they basically said, well, if you want to focus Reddix, you're going to have to fight all three of us in this small, closed space, and it worked out perfectly for G2.
Alright, SK walking over some scout traps right now, but that's the Blast Tremor going down. Jetpacks finds Reddix this time, but look at the healing coming through onto him. Finally, that is a kill that SK is able to pick up. They get Dark Potato as well. Dingo, the last man standing for the side of G2. Should be able to get away from this one. I don't think Raf and Jetpacks have the damage. I would imagine, at least, especially with him getting under the turret. The execute might come through. They want to keep going for it very boldly, but they do find it. It's an ace for SK. And they finally get a good fight.
Wow, the difference a breaking point can make on a Black Feather. Able to dive onto the backline this time, quickly shut down. Reddix, easily secures a teamfight win for SK, and when we're starting to count them out, all of a sudden they come back in, and I feel like that was a mistake, especially on my part, given how this series has gone so far.
Yeah, I know how you feel. There is comebacks aplenty in the EU, and in this series, we have seen so many close games, it would almost be kind of strange if it wasn't. And Jetpacks get to the point where he has a little bit more damage, Waldemar getting to the point where he's a little bit tankier. And if they can get onto Reddix, they can maybe close things out. Fountain of Renewal did so much work from Dingo there, though.
Certainly did. Fountain of Renewal is such a great item, and it's often why teams will prioritize it in these drawn-out fights. And it provides you with a lot of shield. The regeneration is just so invaluable, and I would highly recommend, if you're new to the game, picking it up, pick one of those up. Sometimes you will actually see double Fountain of Renewal if it's very much revolved around an individual. But
Kraken been kicked off the G2. Yeah, SK just not even close to going for that one. So G2 have an opportunity now to make a big push. They've also managed to secure themselves, I think, their gold mine. So, or rather, mini mine. They're in a decent spot. Raph eating a lot of damage on the front line, but is going to be able to back away here.
Dragon's Breath.
Jetpacks. Yeah, the Dragon's Breath popped maybe. Oh. Whoa, never mind. I thought it was a little bit early, but not even close. Now they're trying to turn this one around onto Reddix, but the health value is already so low on the side of SK. They're just fighting from behind. Raph gets stunned up. The Kraken lumbers on forward towards the base without a care in the world for the carnage behind him. G2, they're looking convincingly like they're going to be taking this to a game 5.
Yeah, they certainly are. I don't think there's anything that SK are going to be able to do. The damage is too much from G2, and what looked like a potential comeback from SK ends up being a convincing victory for G2, and in my opinion, the first convincing victory of this whole series.
Oh, absolutely. The first, sort of dominant victory, I suppose you could say it that way. SK only really had one or two glimpses of hope there. G2, maybe they've found the secret sauce finally. You know, they've been taking a few games to understand their opponents a little bit more. However, the real question as to whether they understand their opponents fully enough is going to come in the blind pick moving forward.
It certainly is, and speaking about that special sauce, I'll tell you the key ingredient, and I think it's Potato 9, 1, and 5 in this game, having such a massive impact, going for a bit of an early game build with that tension bow, certainly working out in his favor, was able to have a massive impact on that glaive, really impressive stuff from him, and coming into this game 5 between these two teams, I'm excited to see what's going to be brought out.
I think potato in a sauce would be a really interesting ingredient. Maybe a sauce on potatoes would make sense, but I see where you were going with it. Let's see if Humanist and Rome get it either. We're going to be passing back to them as we get underway or get on the way into our final game of the series.
Well, thank you once again, Action Jackson and Vedius. You guys sure do keep it interesting, and we got to appreciate that. But G2 able to pick up a win here in match number 4, send it to the 5th game, and this is going to be insane. Blind picks, Rome, it doesn't get any better than this. I mean, coming into this, you thought G2 was going to have the advantage. They definitely can secure it here, and these teams are going to get whatever they want. In this situation, do you favor either of these teams, like in when we go into blind pick?
To be honest, going to this last match, I have this like huge itch that it is going to be a fairly close mirror match, in fact, with both teams trying to get that scarf and perhaps trying to follow up by grabbing a Krul.
Yeah, so if you go with the scarf Krul, and then we start thinking about their roamers, like what do you think that they maybe could pick up the plug in there to kind of round it out and maybe give one side an advantage, if that's what we see?
And here is like where the roamers will make a big difference, especially going into a blind pick match where there is a possibility that both teams have the same comfort picks. Most likely there will be an Arden coming out as if he fits in probably as the best here. But to be honest, if one of the teams does pull out Finn, in fact, I think I have to give it to them. Overall, I think Finn does really great here in terms of if he's able to use his Polite Company, his Forced Accords at the right time, he could pretty much put his entire team in a position where they have the better and a more advantage engage.
Yeah, and that's all due to positioning. A lot of that, you know, fortification that he brings to the table, I think it's very deceptive in a lot of cases. But we've seen teams go away from Finn,
And even Team Secret, who have the All-Star Finn and Mowgli, you know, they really went away from him. So, yeah, I'd be surprised to see it come out here. But, you know, definitely Rome is our analyst here, and we could see it come out and maybe play to great effect. And, yeah, all right, we're going to see. This is the Dark Potato Show, man. He came out. That last game was something beautiful. And we'll see. Can he pull it together? Can he have this full five-game series of just absolutely dominating performance? But we'll find out really quickly, guys. We do have draft ready. We'll hop into this blind pick right now and find out what these teams want. And are they going to get exactly comfort picks? Are they going to kind of keep in mind what you know their opponents are going to be running? Do you think that is? I mean, is it? They get this. You can get that Cruel Scarf, right? Because you know that like that's like very strong for you. But if you could just counter that in like the perfect way, what would be the perfect comp to just counter that?
To be honest, grabbing somebody very strong in the early game, and this is not like balancing it out, grabbing a passive, but this is just going straight in, and it's very North American style, I would have to say,
yeah,
in terms of like you're trying to get yourself a Ringo, a Koshka, and a Fortress, and you're trying to dominate very early to a point where it's literally a snowball. Mm-hmm. This is probably like one of the best ways to approach very passive comps in terms of getting that Cruel, getting that Scarf, and I think these teams have the capability, and they have ran it before. I'm just not too sure. Going to a blind pick for the final match of this first place in this qualifier. So, in terms of like coming in with that mindset, that mentality ahead of time, they have a lot of pressure on them, and how they execute this will actually be very detrimental to how they win the game.
I mean, it's all on the line here, right? For the second winter qualifier, and this it comes down to the fifth game. The hype is real. It's like hype overdrive. I heard Blueberries in the background. He was just like, hype who, man? This is like big deal here. So I'm really excited. I'm glad it went to the game five. I mean, if this was a best of three, SK would have already claimed their victory. Because
but it's not.
They were up, but it's not. Exactly. And so we go to game five here, and it's anyone's call, like how this is going to play out. I think especially because both of these teams are such deep thinkers. But sometimes you start to chase your own tail when you get in that situation. You can overthink things. You're kind of like reverse psychology yourself. So I don't know. Like it's hard to like theorycraft too hard on it.
But here we have like two very big organizations in the European scene with SK and G2. So for the viewers out there, like put into chat like which teams they're going to root for to win.
Yeah.
We'll see how that goes. Like who's going to take the side.
That's right, you guys. Spam that chat. Let them know who's going to win this match. But we do have blind picks ready right now. We'll pull that up and hop right into it. Will it be SK Prometheus? Will it be G2 Kinglin? Oh, only time will tell. I'm going with SK. Rome, you're in the G2 bandwagon.
And we're already seeing here, like, I was actually thinking Fortress is a perfect pick in this scenario because he also gives, like, Cruel a very good early game. And as long as they're able to execute it outright, I think they have a great advantage, even if SK Prometheus runs something like out of the blue.
Well, they're kind of flipping around through their picks here. I mean, Scarf is locked in. There you go. Fortress, Cruel. And as you said, Fortress, he adds a lot to Cruel's toolset. You know, the mobility factor coming out of Fortress is a huge deal. Their ability to jump into the back line, if need be, lifesteal, all of that good stuff. The bleed coming out. Oh, man. What? Okay, we see right here, but SK, they haven't locked in their picks.
I think this is going to be a mirror comp.
You think so?
Yeah, I think this will be a mirror comp.
What a way to see match number five played out. If we do the mirror comp right here, and it looks like SK just having a little trouble locking in at the end, but if we see this mirror comp, I mean, it comes down to match number five. You've got the same heroes. You know, you've gone the full distance in the finals, and it's really just going to be a complete showing of you being the better team.
Yeah, but the thing is, if they do pick a Fortress into that comp like they did already, they do have to know, like, unless you're going to start building Crystal, like, fairly early on that roamer, you do tend to fall off into that mid to late game. And if the other team doesn't grab a Fortress, and instead they opt out, grab a, in terms of for a roamer, they grab that Arden up.
Yeah.
Their early game, fairly weaker, that's true, but they do have, like, way better in terms of being able to zone out their opponents using that Gauntlet. Having that Vanguard up for them will really help them into that mid to late game when they're very strong. But as we see here, I'm assuming that they will be running a pretty much a mirror match, and this will be exciting to watch because both of these teams are known for their scarfs and their curls.
Yeah, it's gonna be crazy. And well, I mean, it's like I said, it's gonna be showing what team, of course, is better. But also, it comes down to the item choices, the compositions, your movements. Everything's on the line here, guys. We are loaded into the fold. It is a mirror match, and we'll toss it over to our casters, Action Jackson and Vedius. Guys, I can't wait. Take it away.
Wow, what a way to do things in the final game of the final series of the final qualifiers of the winter season. A straight up entirely mirror match. I just can't wait to see Attack of the Pack popped on both sides. That's going to make my game lag, probably.
So many puppies everywhere. They're going to want cuddles, they're going to want love, and they're going to create chaos all over the map. I'm super hyped. I think this is a great way to end the final. You know, you go all the way to five games, and then it's simply a matter of, let's decide who the best team is by literally putting both of them with the same comps and who can execute it better. This is going to be great. Really excited. Dingo, he may be the one trying to kick Action off.
Yeah, you can see G2 rotating very quickly down for a fight here with Reddix. They wanted to catch some, couldn't quite find it, though. Raf29 played it safely enough to get away. I'm unsure, like, how do you talk about
the win conditions?
Like, advantages, right? Like, where do you build an advantage? Sort of by comp, you don't. So it has to be entirely by skill and rotations and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So I'm looking around and I'm like, okay, well, Reddix, he rotated down, didn't get something, so Waldemar has two more farm. It's all over, boys!
This game is purely decision-making, mechanics, positioning. It is very little to do with comp. It is simply a matter of execution, and that's why this blind pick game 5 is fantastic. And Dingo, gonna collapse onto Waldemar, but just coming out for a bit of poke.
Who wins out of fire and ice? Because we've got two different scarf skins up in the top lane.
Scientifically, fire wins. Sorry, it's just science.
Well, I don't know about that. I mean,
I'm going to hit you with the science hammer there. It is science that, in fact, fire will melt ice, I'm afraid.
You were trying to tell me before the game started that a scarf made of ice would keep you warm. And you want to bring up science and heat-related things now?
Well, I'm not getting into the whole scarf fiasco.
No, I will agree that it was a fiasco.
You threw a curveball in the woods. Let's remind the audience what these teams are playing for here, because this is game 5. Winner is going to secure, I believe, top seed in the live championships, given how the points work. And on top of that, these guys are playing for some big prizes here.
Yeah, they are indeed. First place, $2,500. Second place, $1,000. To be honest, I'd be pretty happy with either. But I think these guys are going to be happier with first place than second. Dingo caught out a little bit right now. Look at the damage coming through. Lots of stacks. That's the first blood going the way of SK in this final game. Immediately response comes through from Dark Potato. I mean, that was like exactly the same.
Yeah, that was exactly the same. That's why Dark Potato now to Voldemort.
Oh! Big smite coming through. Dark Potato breaks us out of the cycle, right? There's no more deja vu. They managed to get out of the cycle.
There's the weapon of mass destruction. That's what I was waiting for. Dark Potato doing what he does best, just potatoing. And that was such a great smite. Applying all those weakness bats, getting that very early burning salvo, gives you some attack speed, allows you to apply those stacks, and then you go for that Vengeful Smite. Massive chunk of damage. Waldemar did not expect that one bit, but there was very little he could do about it regardless. You can see he already popped the boots, but just wasn't enough. So G2, they're going to be the ones to take the initial lead in the kill score. Gold is still in favor of SK.
Yeah, and that's, you know, at least in part down to CS numbers. Interesting to see who can pull ahead a little bit later on, though. It's interesting that both these teams did actually pick the same comp. Like, I know we've talked about it to an extent, but it shows a lot about the mentality of European teams, doesn't it? It's like, Kroll, Scarf, those things are good. Let's get those in.
Yeah, we do quite like our Krolls and Scarf over here. And this is why I'm super excited for international tournaments in particular, you know? I think that the varying metas internationally would create some really interesting competition. I mean, I've still seen some Kestrel over in NA. Dingo, though,
Oh, he is very low right now, but Waldemar doesn't have enough energy to commit to it, and the turret was on him whilst he was moving forward because of the burn damage, so Dingo is able to get away. Gonna be denying SK the chance to tie up the kills, 2-for-2. Doing alright here, they're actually in the gold lead now, which, even though they had the kill lead earlier, wasn't the case.
It's a very passive game. Obviously, you expect that to be happening when you have two teams playing for that first place spot. But G2 may be the aggressors in this first fight.
Yeah, they might be trying to find something here. Can they pick up a kill? Jetpacks is going to be taking a lot of damage. Dark Potato gets his smite down first. To find themselves another kill this game. So in the mirror matchup, they are certainly pulling ahead for the time being. Now rotating towards this lane. Wrath is taking a lot of damage, but Reddick's burned his goop on bot, thinking that they might keep trying to fight it, and they didn't. So only going to be the one kill picked up for a G2.
Yeah, G2, as you rightly said, just optimizing the composition a little bit better in the early game, catching SK out of position, and slowly starting to build that advantage up in their favor. So, G2, I mean, when I think about these two teams, I mean, obviously, oh, hang on, Reddix.
Oh, that's a lot of damage coming through. Easy pickup for the side of SK. They finally get their second kill. Very nice work by them. They've also got the lane pushing in their favor right now, with Waldemar still pretty high on energy. Be in a good spot to go for that turret if they... That doesn't look like they're going to. We have got the first big item completed, though, for each team. Looks like Reddix is going to be going for that Eve of Harvest, so lots of sustain coming out from him.
So I was literally just about to say, before that play happened, to me, Palmatoro has always been one of the more well-known Krull players in Europe. And then Jetpacks just comes flying out of the bush and he was like, you want me? And then quickly, easily secures the kill down onto Reddix. Just really demonstrating that they both deserve mad props in their ability to play Krull, because from Hellsart does come out from Dark Potato. He does miss it.
Yeah, Waldemar's still in a tough spot, though. Look at that damage. Dingo picks that one up, actually. Now he's going to be in a maybe bit of a dicey position. Another missed from Hell's Heart. They got to match it, man. If one misses, the other one's got to miss.
It wouldn't be a mirror matchup otherwise, am I right?
Yeah, exactly.
Right now, though, game returning to normality as both teams just posture around, do their best to pick up farm. G2 actually initiating the gold mine.
Got a lot of damage for this. Dingo is fairly low, though. The steal comes through from Jetpacks. Very nice work by him. Be evening up the fact that there's two more kills on G2's side. Actually dead even at the moment. Reddix trying to get under his turret safety, but we've seen this before. We know how it ends. It's going to be a kill going over to SK.
Oh, boy.
Very bad. I feel like going back and watching Primer again. You seen that movie?
No. Is it very back and forth? Because that's pretty much how I would sum up this game
right
now.
It's one of those time travel movies that just kind of messes with your head. but things keep repeating.
I see. Well, that aptly describes this game so far. Both SK and G2. I mean, I wish I could highlight the win conditions, but I mean, pretty much both teams want to kill the other team's Scarf. And Dark Potato, he's going to initiate on that now.
It just keeps happening. It's like, I feel like if I did legitimate play-by-play for these dives, it would be the same every time. Like, there's only a limited amount of variation I can actually put into this. Oh, we got Scarf going down here to the dive, coming out from... Yeah, it's just the same. It's the same every time.
Well, from Hell's Heart, gonna miss from Dark Potato, so SK now have that ultimate advantage.
But
question is, can they land it?
Miss it? No, it's cursed. It's
Oh man, G2 doing what they can. Falling behind, even with the kill advantage that they do have. Baton of Renault being picked up for Wrath, so same thing for Dingo. Literally, hang on, I want to check. Oh, they have varied up their
different builds. Yeah.
Yeah, different builds. So we can highlight on that. Dark Potato going more aggressive with the early Sorrow Blade and the double Burning Salvo. Reddix taking a lot of damage, Dingo as well.
Whoa. Reddix actually gets stunned up there, so a lot of that Dragon's Breath goes to waste. Jetpacks might be wanting to flank in here and go for a kill. Reddix is stuck behind the turret. Not in the safest of positions right now with Jetpacks flanking in. That's going to be a Fountain of Renewal going across, though. Is it going to be enough? Got backup from Dark Potato. They want to turn it around. It's a 1-for-1 right now. Different people died on each side. Starting to get mixed up a little bit.
They certainly are. Waldemar's not actually able to secure himself the kill, but Reddix is, and this is big for G2 because the main damage dealers are going to be those scarves in play. But notice, you know, it comes back to this itemization difference. As Dingo takes a chunk of damage, it's a bit of a bait.
Dark Potato lands from Hell's Heart, though, and Wrath 29 does get baited in. So we got 7-4 right now. G2 doing a great job here. You mentioned it before, but I actually feel like it's worth highlighting again just to bring up the point. Dark Potato 403 right now, Jetpacks 42-0. Dark Potato really is the secret sauce, I think, for the side of G2. And he's someone who has seen play Kroll so much. I think it's showing a little bit here.
Yeah, it's not like Jetpacks is a bad Kroll whatsoever. I mean, you can see it in his score 4-2-0. But Dark Potato has been the one setting up all of these plays. He has been the primary damage dealer with the itemization that he's decided to go for. And the way in which he executes this Kroll is just really coming up to par with what you can see so far. 4-0-3, 100% kill contribution, and he is just working wonders in this final game.
Yeah, we talked about items being different between the two teams earlier. I also want to highlight the differences in builds between Waldemar and Reddix. Reddix going for the sustain with the Eve of Harvest, like we mentioned earlier. Waldemar going for the kite potential with the Frostburn. So, in a more extended fight, it's actually kind of hard to tell who's going to come out ahead. Whoa, look at the damage Dark Potato just did to Waldemar, though. He's going to have to back away. We've got that fountain ticking onto him. Reddix now kiting back. But look at this. Waldemar has a ton of damage with his own Dragon's Breath. SK actually winning that fight fairly convincingly.
So the gold miner being involved in that fight was a big problem for G2. Their target was somewhat split up because Reddix was trying to deal with this gold miner hitting on his face, which meant that he couldn't be dishing the damage down onto SK. That kind of left Dark Potato in a bad spot, and he's going to get his first death of the game. So very tight stuff from both these teams, and G2 doing what they can to stay relevant. But falling behind a little bit into... I say falling behind. They're actually perfectly even once again in gold. And they do actually lead in kills. It's the curse of these mirror matchups, man. They blow with your mind. You know, like, oh, the scarf is ahead.
I'm just kind of... I mean, I feel like it's almost impossible for either team to win, right? If they trade evenly, consistently throughout the game, it just can't end. Although, right now, Dingo is going to be caught out in a bad spot. Going to go down. Might see a little bit of a chase come here, and doesn't look like SK want to commit to it. There's a fully stacked gold mine they could be going for. Question is, do they want to risk it? Reddix has the Dragon's Breath available yet again. Waldemar, about to. Dark Potato is very, very strong, so they just find a good opening here. G2 can still do damage, even though it's 2 versus 3. Wrath 29 doesn't want to wait for that. Reflex block perfectly timed by Reddix. Waldemar, not quite, but it doesn't matter. There's just an outnumbering issue on the side of G2. Let's get another kill picked up for SK Prometheus.
Yeah, he tried so hard, but it doesn't even matter. Great reflex block, but that is going to be a gold miner secured for SK. And Dark Potato could lose his life here.
Could indeed, but we've got Dingo coming in to support him. He doesn't find a smite there. Looks like Dark Potato is going to be going down, and all of a sudden, we're now 8-8. They just had to, even it up.
But SK lead in terms of gold thanks to the gold miner that they were able to pick up. And so far, given that SK were in the deficit in kills, they've done a good job to work their way back into this. Their engagements have been good. There's also a turret difference, but clear that gold miner working out in favor. You have to look at the farm as well, which is actually very even. I don't know where that goal difference comes from, AJ. It's an anomaly. But nevertheless, SK do hold it, and they have been the ones setting up these picks. And remember, they were 7-4 behind, and now they've been able to find 4 successful picks consecutively to bring themselves back into this game. So SK executing their composition a little bit better than their mirror match counterparts. But we'll have to see whether or not they can maintain that consistency as both teams now meet up in the lane.
Dingo takes a lot of poke there. Attack at the pack gets popped by Wrath 29. They're going to be looking for some damage here under the turret, but I think they're not going to be able to go for it too easily. Dingo actually hovering around, looking like he wanted to go for that counter engage, but the poke coming into Waldemar is doing a lot more work than Reddix. Reddix is having to spend a lot of his time dealing with the minion wave, or choosing, I suppose is maybe a better way of describing it, choosing to use Damage there. Reddix might get jumped on here. It's going to be going down yet again. Jetpacks and Raph find that kill with Waldemar. And now for the first time in a while, SK leading in terms of they're going to get the turret, even up those turret kills. Start building a bit more of a substantial gold lead for themselves.
That was just a big misplay from Reddix. He took a path which he shouldn't have because SK could clearly see where you were walking and the rest of his team weren't in a position to provide support. Big misplay from Reddix. It's going to cost G2 a turret and it could cost them the Kraken.
Yeah, it could indeed. Dingo doesn't look like he has any inclination to go down here and stop this. Neither does Dark Potato. They're just sitting in the lane. Gotta know that SK are on it. They do find themselves the first Kraken, and this is where the deviation between the mirror matchups really starts to show. We've got lots of infusions picked up on the side of SK as well. Again, if you are playing a mirror matchup and you have infusions and they don't, that's pretty clearly a big advantage for your team. So, how much they can take off the back of this? Looking towards that second turret.
Yeah, this is where you're also starting to see the difference in items as well, because Waldemar has itemized to deal with Dark Potato being a massive damage dealer, whereas Reddix cannot match with the poke that Waldemar is consistently putting out, because Jetpacks is looking to be a front line while Waldemar does damage from the back, and it's the opposite for G2, and you can see which one is coming out ahead in this game.
Yeah, it's very interesting. If you guys ever wanted some tips on how to build these characters, this could end up being a pretty good example. Attack the pack popped on both sides. There's bugs everywhere, but who's going to come out ahead in the fight? Lots of damage going down to Dark Potato. He's the first to fall. Reddix just barely makes it back to base. Waldemar healing up just a little bit with the Fountain of Renewal. We've still got Kraken fairly healthy here. Looking to pick up the first Vayne Crystal turret. It goes down. There's only one left standing. They could try and end right now. The Vayne Crystal is exposed. It's taking a lot of damage. All three members still alive for SK. They want to close it out. Reddix,
they done it.
He can't do anything. It's going to be SK Prometheus taking home the win. What a crazy finals for this second qualifier, Vettius.
And what a way to end it as well. It was so even for so long. G2 had the initial advantage, getting the kill lead, SK slowly working their way back into things, and then all of a sudden they get one catch onto Reddix, they get themselves a turret, they get themselves a Kraken, they straight up end the game in 17 minutes. Phenomenal stuff from SK. And what a best of five series. So back and forth, so equally skilled teams. And I think both are strong contenders coming into the live championships.
Oh, you are definitely right. There's a lot of strong competition in Europe. I mean, we saw, of course, Team Secret playing out of their minds earlier on as well today. But just looking at these guys, you know, I feel like it could have gone either way in this last game almost, based off of a few fights. The differences in builds really started to become apparent later on. G2, they weighted their damage more heavily on Dark Potato, and he couldn't snowball as much as he wanted to. You know, on another day, that might have gone differently.
It may very well have done, but in this game, you also have to make the valid point that G2 kept getting caught out of position too many times, exactly like we saw in Game 1. And it was just SK really being the better team when it came into Game 5. But G2, you can't take anything away from them. They performed admirably. They did a great job in this series, and it's absolutely massive. So very well played to SK. Impressive stuff from them, and I'm looking forward to seeing them in the live championships.
All right, well, speaking of which, with Europe all wrapped up, that's it for me and you, Vettius, at least until those live championships. I'm sure you're going to be hearing more about them in just a little bit, but thank you guys for listening, and stay tuned because NA is coming up. We're going to be passing back to the hosts to break down this final game one last time before we hop over the pond and get those games underway.
Wow.